Hello, everyone. Welcome to Kevin Pollock's chat show. I am not Kevin Pollock. My name is Paget Brewster, and I've been asked to guest host while Kevin is out of town, not in jail, but
we're assuming.
Don't know quite where he is.
No.
But doing something fabulous and probably very, very funny. I would like to say, however, that Kevin is the only person not here today. Otherwise, it's all your favorite friends. And with that, what? I have not hosted or interviewed anyone since 1995. That is 19 years. My heart is beating like a squirrel by the side of the freeway.
It's just like you were having a conversation. And
I know.
I do not like attention. I do not like to be on stage ever at all. And this I'm completely comfortable with.
Okay, good. Then let's keep the camera on you.
I also
let's find out how.
You know this is a podcast, right?
Most people are doing the listening audio. Like
yeah,
the
they're,
audio
they're only listening to us. They can't see. They can't see the flop sweat coming off you right now.
Am I sweating?
Not at all.
Where's Sonia?
You're not sweating at all.
No, I do. I appreciate that. Thank you. But I do feel like I can control my fear. Oh, no one's sitting there yet. If I acknowledge it.
Yeah.
So thank you for being here.
Yeah.
And I hope you enjoy this. Now, Sam, Jamie, how's your week been?
Oh, thank you so much for asking, Paget. It was a lovely week. Just a lovely week. I've been looking forward to this all week, quite frankly, because I don't get to see you as often anymore. So this is a delight. And also our guest, who may or may not be in the room. And you're doing great.
Okay.
We're gonna have great fun today.
All right.
We went to a lovely baseball game.
We did go to a lovely baseball game. Yeah, we saw the Pirates beat the Dodgers.
We did on Friday.
And where are the Pirates from?
They're from Pittsburgh.
Which is where Well, I'm from Pittsburgh, so be careful.
And so I have nothing against Pittsburgh. I said where the Pirates from, and
yes.
The guest who may or may not be in the room said Penzance. Which is a musical
nerd.
Theater yes. insider piece of knowledge. But you had fun at the baseball game.
It was great.
It was a good game.
Good.
It was what you call it, a pitcher. What is it, a pitcher's game? Is it like a pitcher standoff?
It was a pitcher's duel. But
I guess that's what it's
called. Why?
Well, it was a low-scoring game.
Oh, so both pitchers were very good?
Yes. Beckett was not as good since he wound up being the losing pitcher. He's the Dodgers pitcher who had previously pitched a no-hitter on his last start. I don't want to get too technical here, but yeah.
And the other pitcher?
Francisco Liriano pitched for the Pirates, and he was great.
And he won?
He did. He was the winning pitcher. I think he went six innings and gave up no runs.
Good. Six?
That's
a lot?
That's a lot. That's a lot.
Six innings.
That's a good start. That's a good start.
Okay, great.
It's 18
ounce. I'm glad you had fun at the. I don't know much about sports.
That's okay. I couldn't tell.
Oh, God. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, our guest today is someone I have known for 9 years. What are you laughing about that for?
Already wrong.
What?
We'll get to it.
Well, if you can't tell by that voice who I'm about to introduce, you need to be more familiar with his work, which I think everyone should be, frankly. My guest, an original Work Juice player, as I am myself, was kind enough to agree to this experiment today, or forced to.
No,
he didn't blackmail you? And say, cover my ass in this, because I can't be there to interview, so you're going to have to help her out, because she's a bag of neuroses. No.
Not in so many words, no.
Sorry, I'm going to introduce him. His name is Marc Evan Jackson.
Hello. Hello. Hello, Paget.
Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, my goodness. Kevin did not have to blackmail me into this in the slightest. This is a ball.
Okay.
You're going to be amazing at this. And to have 2 hours of focus time, 3 hours, 4 hours, how long are we going?
We'll
6 hours of focus time talking
to
you is a delight, and I can't wait.
6 hours. Marc Evan Jackson.
Hello.
You actually were a professional host on NPR.
On an NPR affiliate in West Michigan back in the
But 90s. That still counts as NPR.
I'd like to believe so. I don't think NPR would claim it, but yeah.
So how did you learn how to do that?
Oh, so when you work for a national public radio affiliate station, which are often associated with universities, they're not lying during their pledge drives. They are understaffed. They are underfunded. And so I got thrown in to hosting because on a Friday afternoon. I was the producer for a 3 hour per day, 9 to noon, Monday through Friday, call-in talk show.
Wow.
Kind of like an air talk or talk of the nation from NPR.
Was there a specific topic?
It was news generally, but okay. You know, there'd be newsmaker interviews and some public interest stuff and culture and what have you. But I was the producer of it, so I was booking guests and screening calls and doing all that up until one Friday afternoon when they fired the host and then said, Monday morning, you're the host. And I was 24 or 25 years old and knew nothing, less than I do now.
Wow.
And and was meant to, you know, talk to senators and congressmen and the mayor and stuff. And it was...
That's terrifying.
It was terrifying. Although I think, you know, I was ignorant and blissfully so that I just kind of did it. But it was, you know, it was daunting. Because I, like you, am not a sports fan. And so I remember... I called Scott Simon from Weekend Edition Saturday at NPR and thought, I'll try this. Let's see what happens. So I called him one day and left a message thinking, well, that, you know, obviously it was even his producer's voice on Scott Simon's voicemail. And that's how much gatekeeping I thought was going on. So I wanted to talk to him to go, like, top three bullet points of hosting, or, you know, how do you conduct interviews on a subject about which you know nothing or whatever. And he called back later that day. He was on the set of a Frontline show he was shooting that day. And he said, if you have questions, if you have genuine curiosity, so does some of your audience, there'd be no interview to do if you knew everything about the subject. And, you know, there'd be no questions to ask. So he sort of removed the pressure for knowing everything in the world. And so that was a big help. And then I conducted a 3 hour per day, Monday through Friday, 9 to noon, call-in talk show with zero callers in, by the by.
Oh. No one called in?
Mm-mm.
Not so even your family? Or you didn't get your friends to do it? Or no
it was,
one?
It was a pre-taped call-in show. That was the problem.
That was it.
So people didn't know what time to call before the show
so
aired.
That's why was it a call? Okay. See, I believed you. I totally believed you, like, they kind of left you out to dry.
No. It was live, but there were very few callers. So the handful of callers that we had would call in on every subject, you know, several times per hour kind of thing. And it was a backwater, underproduced show for a great station, a great couple of stations, WGVU AM and FM in West Michigan. Mm-hmm. And then I would also, they were like, you know, we'd really like an hour-long news magazine at noon. Could you also produce and host that? And so I think, you know, this was in the mid-90s, I think I was making $17,500 a year, working all the time. At one point I was legitimately working 7 days a week because I would host the local host from 6 a.m. to 10 or 6 a.m. to noon, on Saturdays and Sundays as well.
So now, did that burn you out on doing that for a living, or did you want to do that for a living?
I wanted to do it, I guess. I enjoyed it, but it was nerve-wracking because, like, I don't read very quickly, and they'd hand you a book and go, tomorrow you're interviewing this author.
Ooh.
And, you know, that'd be this giant tome that they would slap down on your desk, and I'd have to sort of scan through it to not sound like a moron, to, you know whether it was fiction or nonfiction at the very least. And it was
daunting. I thought that was the job of a producer. Is the producer reads, but you were producing and hosting, so it was your job.
It was really...
It was a double job.
I had a ball, for the record, but it was, you know, I was 24, 25 and bulletproof, and maybe 26, but like didn't know any better, and it was graduate school in life, and I learned a ton. I'm certain I did hour after hour of terrible radio, but it was fun.
I think you were probably great, and they knew that you had a fantastic voice.
Well, obviously.
Now, but you already knew that you wanted to act at that point.
No.
Oh, what?
Not really.
See, this is why we have show notes.
I have false information. Out of my hands.
Well, maybe at that point I did.
I heard.
Please.
Read.
You read
that you,
Braille?
I read it in Braille.
See, that all you, your listeners are missing
that
out.
You went to Carter College.
Calvin College. This is going great.
It's all part of my plan.
Calvin Coolidge College.
Calvin Coolidge College. And you got a bachelor's degree in...
Botany.
No. Keep them coming.
Marine biology.
No.
Welding.
No.
Animal husbandry.
Okay, you minored in, good ones, minored in business acumen? No. Wait, you got it.
Just ask him, stop guessing.
Not psychology, it's philosophy.
That's my major. Yeah.
Okay.
What does she win? What does she win? What does she win?
When I get this back on the rails, then I can have some champers.
You know, there are words on these pages in front of you.
But it's like a commercial for that
change
we have
nothing.
To do later.
I love it. Change nothing.
No. I have. You know what I have here is I have your IMDb Pro resume.
Yeah.
Okay. Now I had heard. Are you a member of IMDb Pro?
I think so, yeah.
So can you go in and change information?
Is this something we should discuss later, maybe?
Yeah.
I think you can. I think you can correct errors or something, right?
You wanted to take your birthday off?
There's been a lawsuit on this subject very recently.
She lost.
Yeah.
And
she lost
the lawsuit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What if you wanted to say, plays?
You want to put your range?
Because that's what the kids are doing now. It doesn't matter. I'm fine with my age. Let's get back to you.
I don't know.
So you had a bachelor, you have a bachelor's degree.
In philosophy with minors in?
In, you do it.
Political science.
Yeah.
And environmental studies.
What the?
And nearly French, but I think I'm a class or two away from a minor in French.
Je suis désolé. But I thought that you went to an acting, you went to play piano.
Yes.
At a show, and you saw people improvising.
Mm-hmm.
So you also play piano.
I do, yeah.
Which is extraordinary. Like, already, you're just
No, I'm
good
fascinating.
At everything.
I'm fascinating, yeah.
It's true!
Yeah.
And then you discovered then that you wanted to improvise.
That part is true. I grew up doing a lot of music. I studied piano from the age of 6, through the time that I was a junior in high school, and then, and I suppose this is common, after I stopped taking lessons, started playing a lot more, because it wasn't work anymore, and it was just fun. I played in a Dixieland band with kids from my high school when I was in high school, and we were good. It was I played a lot of instruments. I played piano, studied percussion from 5th grade through college, and French horn from 7th grade through college.
So you could pick up a French horn and play it.
Why does that make you angry?
Well, isn't that the hardest horn to play?
Maybe of horns, but double reeds I think are widely
What's
accepted.
A double reed?
Like an oboe or an English horn? It's a woodwind?
I feel like a French horn is harder.
Okay.
All right.
Get them in here.
Seen you play flugelhorn.
Mm-hmm, you have.
I saw you play a flugelhorn.
Similar. Actually, a lot easier than the French horn.
Now, there's two different types of French horn.
There are.
Like the concert French horn, which is like the round one that you're probably used to, but
big,
then the
big,
marching one
kind
is
of brassy,
like,
round one.
I feel like the marching one is known as a mellophone. Am I correct about that, I believe? Euphonium's different, that's like a baritone. But yeah, I think a marching French horn is a mellophone. I think I'm right about
that. Can we get the judges on that?
Is someone
They're
going to
say yes.
Only we have the internet.
The judges have said yes.
But there are two different French horns. There's an F horn, which is just three valves, and then a B-flat horn, which is what I played, which also has a thumb valve.
Oh my God, you're showing off.
Oh, you'll know when I'm showing off.
I'm sad that I didn't learn how to play piano. Do you have a piano in your home?
I do.
Oh.
Yeah, I bought one a couple years ago.
Do you have a French horn in your home?
I don't. French horns are expensive. There's a lot of plumbing to a French horn, and so I think because they're expensive, high schools and middle schools, or junior highs back in the day, often owned their own and would lend them to the students. So I never owned one. And I thought about buying one a couple years ago, but they're very expensive. A good French horn is like $4,000.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, how much is a good piano?
My piano is much more than that.
It's very nice. Yeah. You have a very nice piano.
No, it's an upright piano, but there are a lot of moving parts, so it's expensive. Yeah.
Something dirty about upright.
You know, if you go to buy a digital piano,
yeah,
they will try everything they can to sell you an upright piano instead.
Is that right?
Why?
Everything they can.
Because of money.
Nobody buys those anymore.
But did you buy yours vintage or secondhand?
Trust me.
Here's a story. There's a place in West Los Angeles called Pierre's Fine Pianos, and he sells new pianos and good used pianos. And so I found, I live in Venice, and the houses are very close to one another, like 6 feet away from one another. Like, we can hear our neighbors snore and stuff.
Right.
So I am sometimes up late, so I was considering getting a digital piano, and played some very expensive ones, some very nice ones that I see the rock and roll kids playing on the stages.
But these are keyboards.
Keyboards, digital, but like okay, the great. Red ones, the Nords, okay. The good ones. And I didn't love it. I didn't love the action of it. It felt more like an organ. Even the weighted ones didn't. Mm-hmm. I wasn't in love with. And so it turns out that Yamaha in Japan makes the perfect balance. It's a proper upright piano. It's a 48-inch upright piano, but it has a silent mode wherein you push down the middle pedal, down and over, and then underneath the deck there's a little sampled grand audio deck that you can put in headphones and play with the proper weighted action, but you can...
It's silent the hammers, to the rest of the house.
To the rest of my neighborhood, yeah.
To everyone.
It's just in the headphones.
So how often would you say you play?
I play every day.
Every day?
Yeah.
Wow.
That's dedication.
He's a proficient.
But no, it's joy. It's like, it's fun. Like, it's an outlet. It's, you know, I can think about other things.
Can your cats play, like in the Aristocats?
Oh, do they ever climb up?
They do.
Gong, gong, gong.
No.
My cats actually love laying on the piano, on top of the piano when I'm playing. I think that's,
They're, because they like the vibration or something.
Right, don't get dirty about it, but yeah.
They just want to be close to you.
Now, how many cats do you have? I'm going to guess three.
Three.
Oh! What are their names, please?
Their names are Charlie, Penny, and Snug.
Is there a story, a history?
To felines?
Not the species. Let me ask you this.
Please.
And tell me if you don't want to discuss this. This could be private. I believe that your wife, I know her name is Beth. I've met her several times. Mm-hmm. She's lovely. And she is a veterinarian.
She is a veterinarian.
Did you get those cats, those three cats, because they were cast-offs from some terrible situation at your wife's workplace?
Yes.
I knew it. Does one of them, is anyone missing a or more than one leg?
No. None of our current cats have.
Oh!
So I met my wife back in Detroit. I met Beth because I had a cat back in Detroit back in the late 90s who got sick. And I took him to the doctor and was waiting in a room not much larger than this table for the doctor to come in with my cat on my lap. And my wife walked in the room. And we.
Is that awkward for you and Beth?
Hey. Do you see what he's saying? He suggested that there was a third person.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. And that she was there with you.
Small room.
Please.
I'm going to interrupt you just for a second because Beth is such a perfect match for you because you're both so inherently elegant and no, it's true. And Beth is like a female beautiful version of you. You look like you should be in an ad. I don't know what for.
Brooks Brothers.
Maybe, yeah, Brooks Brothers or yachts, private yachts. And you also make yachts.
I sail boats.
You make sailboats.
I sail boats.
Sail them.
Yeah.
You don't make them.
No.
I read that you worked on a schooner.
I sailed them. I didn't make them. That happened 100 years ago.
I misread that.
Okay.
Back to Beth. You're waiting in the vet's office. Your cat is in your lap.
Yeah.
And sick.
And this woman walks in, and I later found out that we had a two-way star in the eye twinkle moment. Yeah. And I had it for real. I, you know, a few minutes in after talking about why I was there, we're standing next to one another, and she has her stethoscope in and is listening to my cat's heart. And I was like, I'm going to kiss her. And then I was like, wait, you could go to jail today. Like, you can't.
You were thinking, I'm going to kiss her, like, right now?
Yeah.
I'm just going to lean over and kiss her?
Yeah.
You didn't, though.
No.
You asked her out.
No.
What did you do?
He poisoned his cat so that he'd keep having to come back.
Munchausen
by proxy.
Yes. Oh, no. You just had to keep hurting that cat to get back in there.
Not what I said.
Okay. You didn't do that.
No.
All right.
No, but like Beth, as you say, Beth is very put together. And so I figured she certainly doesn't need me in her life. So I did nothing about it. And then a month later, because my cat was sick, about a month later I was coming out to Hollywood, not to move yet, but I was going to be out here about a month to open the Second City space that was next to the Improv on Melrose for many years and has since moved to Hollywood Boulevard. But we were going to come out and develop a show to open that space. And so I was going to bring my cat with me because he had been ill. And in order to fly, he needed a certificate to say that he was well enough to fly or whatever, which he totally was. But I had to go back to Beth to get that certificate. And during that, she asked me out.
Oh!
Yeah.
Wow.
Scandalous.
It is.
No, it was good. So I lived in downtown Detroit at the time, or what they're now calling Midtown. And she said, Beth said, you know, I've been away for many years. I grew up in this area, but I've been away for a while. I'm sure downtown has changed. Maybe you could take me on a tour.
Wow.
And so it was, even as I was waiting for her to meet me at a restaurant in my neighborhood down in Midtown, I was waiting, going like, is she bringing her husband? Like, is this, I don't know.
Oh, you didn't, you
I didn't,
did,
I
really
was like,
didn't
is
know
this a
if
date?
It was a date. Oh.
I didn't, I wasn't certain if it was a date. And she walked in alone, and I was like, this is a date. And then we had dinner and coffee and dessert and stuff, and then we went on this, you know, total bullshit tour. And I didn't, when I was, I,
what do you mean a total bullshit tour? What
I didn't
mean?
Know Detroit at all.
Because I was at the so this, you're still going ahead with the,
yeah.
Oh, show me, oh,
right.
Okay, go ahead.
So we're driving around Detroit, which I knew not at all because I was at the Second City at that time, and you're in the process all the time. Like, you're either writing the show or performing a show or whatever.
Okay.
So I hadn't been around Detroit at all. This is long before GPS and phones with nav on them and such. And so we're driving around Detroit, and I literally pull up to a T in the road in the middle of nowhere and kind of sheepishly look left and look right, and I had no idea. And Beth was like, take a left. And I was like, oh, this is a date. She knows exactly where we are. Like, she did not need a tour of the city.
Wow.
Of Detroit. Yeah.
Did you kiss her on the first date?
I did.
Fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
And then did you propose or did she?
This is still on the first date.
Not on the first date. I'm saying because she asked him out first, but she did it beautifully, and I love that.
She did.
I'm wondering if she asked him to marry her, or if he, because I feel like you asked her and probably did it in an old-fashioned way. No?
Yeah. Yes. With an asterisk.
How long after the first date?
Well, this is the issue. So I already had plans. I met Beth, I think, in August of 2000, and I had plans at that time to move 4 months later to Los Angeles.
Mm.
So everything was kind of abbreviated. And when I was leaving Beth in Detroit to drive a budget rent-a-truck to California, she and Seth insists that I very romantically said, will you marry me? And I believe the fact is that I took her hands and looked in her eyes and said, you know we're getting married, right?
Yeah, I could see that.
Yeah.
I think that's probably what you did.
But after that, like once that was established, I did do the arduous, maybe one of the hardest things I've ever had to do, which is I did want to be traditional about it and ask Beth's father for her hand in marriage.
Mm-hmm.
And we, I can't believe we've gotten here. How the hell have we gotten here?
Cats.
Do you want to, I mean, if
no,
you
no,
want to
no.
bail on this.
I don't want to bail.
You can just say pass, and we'll move on to another. But I want to hear you asking her father, because my fiance, no, I hate that word, I told him he had to ask my dad.
Yeah.
And he did.
I was, I'm going to get the math wrong, but I think I was, you know, 30, 31 or something mm-hmm. at that point. Like, I was an adult, and Beth's dad is fantastic. Her family is wonderful, and I love them very much. And did at that time, there was, you know, never any like disapproval of me or anything.
But at this point, you've been together how long?
Maybe a year.
You've been together a year. You knew her parents.
Yeah.
She had met your parents.
Yes.
Okay.
She had met my mother.
Okay.
My
carry
father
on.
Had passed. Yeah. And it was Beth's dad is great. He's a friend of mine to this day. But in a very traditional way. So it was Thanksgiving of 2001, I suppose. My mother had driven to Detroit to spend the Thanksgiving weekend with Beth's family and with Beth and with me. And sort of a trumped up reason for Beth's dad and I to be away was that Beth's dad has just bought he had just purchased a foosball table for the game room, and we were going to assemble it.
So you and he
We went upstairs.
The basement? Or?
Upstairs to the game room. And
to assemble the foosball table, and that this was how you were going to be able to ask him. Did he know it was coming?
Yeah. Oh, everybody in the building.
Everyone knew?
Everybody for miles knew that this was the ruse.
All right, okay.
Also, I think it was an inherent test of my manhood, of whether I could follow instructions and assemble, you know, use Allen wrenches and that sort of thing, which was daunting. But we assembled this thing, and it took a long time, because it's like a bar room. It's a proper foosball table. It's like a bar room foosball table. And we put it together, and it took probably 2 hours or so, during which I not even got close to the subject of marriage or whatever. Like, you're just sitting there twisting Allen wrenches, going like, he knows why we're here. I know why we're here. I don't want to do this.
So for, you're saying almost 2 hours?
Longer than we're going to talk today.
You didn't ask it?
Yeah.
And when did you ask it?
We put it together, we threw the box away.
And we got downstairs
and we're walking through to the kitchen and walking into the family room where Beth and her mother and my mother are, with them all three waiting to go like, did you do it? And we got within 20 feet of it, and I was like, stop! I have to, like, you know that I have to. And I just punted and said, I love Beth very much, and I believe she loves me. And I wanted to say something very traditional, like, it would mean a lot to me to have your approval or what have you. Mm-hmm. And I think I said, I need to make sure you're okay with this madness. I'm certain is actually what I said, yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm. The thing that surprises me the most about this story is I feel like you do everything perfectly and eloquently, and I'm surprised to hear that you, for 2 hours making a foosball table, didn't like grab the
bull by... Working on a foosball table.
Working on it. Like a schooner.
Right.
I'm surprised. I'm very surprised.
It's tough.
I think it would be a scary rite of passage for a man. But I think it has value.
It's my plan to be married once and well. Mm-hmm. And it was a big thing. And I never thought I would, if looking back, you'd go, like, of course you could do it. You just go, this is meaningful to me, and I would ask for your permission and whatever. But in the moment, in the day, I've never felt like younger or, you know, part of you definitely goes, what if he doesn't approve? Like, what if he says no? Which wasn't ever in the cards, but it, you know, I didn't have a job, I didn't have a career at the time. So it was like, I'm gonna ask your daughter to marry what exactly, you know?
Huh. Do you feel he regrets giving you his permission? Which he did, of course, I assume.
He did. No, I don't think he regrets it. No, we're buddies.
You're great.
Well, not now. I mean, he's seen Brooklyn Nine-Nine.
Now, about that.
Have they told you about that?
I know about that. You play Andre Brower's boyfriend, Kevin.
Husband.
Oh, you're married.
It's a recurring theme in Jackson's life.
Now, when did you start professionally acting? Because we've got you have this degree. You're doing NPR. Mm-hmm. You're working on boats and playing piano. When did you start making a living as an actor?
There's a fruit fly in here.
As long as it's over there with you, I don't want it. Oh, I got it. When did you start acting professionally?
So the story that someone told you about. Are you?
I haven't found this.
Is accurate. No, the piano story is accurate. So I played the piano growing up, and a couple years I went sailing on schooners for 2 years after college, and then.
As a first mate.
First, it's a deckhand, and then it's a first mate.
Deckhand, and then a first mate. Yeah. So you were a deckhand, then a first mate.
Correct.
Which is like the top of the food chain, except for the captain,
there
right?
Are captains,
yeah,
like,
right? But that's it.
Yes.
So you were like the vice president
of the
boat. Okay, great. Carry on. For 2 years, good for you.
It's not how the Coast Guard looks at it, but yes. yes, so I did that. But when I went back to Grand Rapids after that, Grand Rapids, Michigan, where Calvin and Hobbes College is, some friends from college had put together an improv company called River City Improv, and they wanted me to come and play they'd asked actually my former college roommate to come play piano for them, and he was like, I don't want to do it, you go do it. And I was truly at the first, I had done a play or two in high school, and I had done a play or two after college, is that right? I don't know. But I was at this first rehearsal playing the piano for them for about 10 minutes, watching what they were doing, and it was a true aha moment where mm-hmm. I thought, we need to find somebody else to come play the piano because I want to do what you're doing right. for the rest of my life.
And did you begin fairly soon after that?
I did, yeah.
With that improv group.
Mm-hmm.
And now you have your own improv group.
I do now, yeah.
The 313.
The 313, yeah.
313 for the Detroit area code?
That's right. It's yeah. the area code of the city of Detroit.
And who else is in that?
So that's those are my buddies from the Second City when I was there. So it's people like Keegan-Michael Key mm-hmm. from Key & Peele, Larry Joe Campbell from The Trouble with Normal.
That was the show that was on briefly
right.
that I was in
that's
with
we
Larry Joe. And then Larry Joe was on, according to Jim, for 15 years.
Eight, yes.
It was on a long time.
It was on a long time.
Yeah.
No, it's good. Mary Beth Monroe from Workaholics and a HBO show coming up called The Brink. Andy Cobb, Mark Warzeka, Jamie Moyer, Margaret Edward-Towski, a lot of folks.
Now, do you perform with this group
I do,
currently?
Yeah. Yeah, it's everybody's pretty busy, thankfully. So we don't have a regular schedule at Second City or Iowa West or anything. But we'll do the occasional. We're going to do the Detroit Improv Festival in early August in a couple of months.
That's exciting.
Yeah.
Have you done it before?
We have, yeah. We're going back.
Great.
Yeah, it's a homecoming. It's a good time.
Nice.
Yeah.
And you also do the Thrilling Adventure Hour.
Hmm?
Oh, it's in the style of old-time radio.
It's a staged production. It's a new time podcast.
Marc Evan Jackson and I both do this, and we've both talked to Kevin Pollak about it.
We have, yeah.
Because he likes it. And he's done
part of it. Yeah, he's done a bunch of it. Yeah.
Where we stand on stage and we read scripts written by Ben Acker, Ben Blacker,
yeah.
Their real names. And Marc Evan Jackson is Sparks Nevada Marshall on Mars.
Correct.
And we perform at least once a month now. Paul F. Tompkins and I play Frank and Sadie Doyle. But Mark and Mark Gagliardi plays Croach the Tracker. So the two Marks mm-hmm. Are the stars of Sparks Nevada Marshall on Mars, and Paul and I do Beyond Belief, and we've been doing it for 9 years.
Yeah,
But it started with you.
It didn't start with me. It started with Sparks Nevada.
Yeah.
But it wasn't me.
What?
The Thrilling Adventure Hour, thrillingadventurehour.com.
You're so good.
Yeah, this is how it works.
You should host this.
Okay, let's do it.
Okay.
Let's try it. The Thrilling Adventure Hour started back in the day because Ben Acker and Ben Blacker, two writing partners who had met at Syracuse University back in the day, had written a Sparks Nevada Marshall on Mars feature script and wanted to hear it out loud. And so they had people over, and it wasn't, I wasn't Sparks Nevada then. I hadn't met them yet. So it was,
I don't remember this.
I wasn't there.
So you wouldn't remember it either.
Holmes Osborne was the name of the actor who played. Do you know Holmes?
I do. He was in. Holmes Osborne is in.
He works a ton.
That Thing You Do. He's the dad.
Okay.
He works a ton. Great guy.
Huh.
And he's been a part of the show since then. In the early days when mm-hmm. we were at M-Bar.
M-Bar, yeah.
Yeah, but yeah, it started with that, and they fell in love with the notion of like, how can we do a low lifting, not much rehearsal, not much blocking, no sets, no costumes, no props kind of thing way to do it, and. That's how they came up with the Thrilling Adventure Hour, which we were at M-Bar for 5 years, and now it's going on 5 years at Largo at
Largo
the Coronet.
Largo Coronet?
Yeah.
Very nice. We have fun.
It's the best.
We have fun backstage.
Last night I was at the New Beverly Cinema.
Oh, that's right. You did a show last night. How was it?
It was really fun. It was a little bit like M-Bar. It was, you know, like we were in full view of the audience the entire time. There's no backstage because it's a small movie theater. But it was a fun event. We did a brief episode of Sparks Nevada Live. Then they screened all of the webisodes, the backstage web series for the Thrilling
Adventure. I've only seen one. Did you see the rest of them?
Well, I saw the rest of them last night. There are six.
What do you think?
It's really fun.
Oh, good. Okay, good. I like the first one.
It's really fun, yeah. They're well made. There's a nice narrative to it. They're pretty. You are hilarious throughout.
Oh, that's nice. You're the most, again, any job that you're given, you do better than anyone else could ever do, because you ended up very eloquently and succinctly explaining what the radio show was. And they interviewed all of us.
I've done it before.
You're very good at that, though.
Thank you.
I'm not very good at that.
That's not true. I can't wait for you to see this web series, and I can't wait for the world to see it, because you're fantastic in it.
Well, thanks, because what I did notice in the first webisode that I saw
mm-hmm.
was while Aaron, I believe, is talking about the challenges of working with actors who maybe don't get there on time or are goofing off, the visual during his speech is me goofing around in a hat.
Was I behind you? I think, because that they love you in that feathery cap, in that it's a black
hat. That one thing that we, we were shooting, but I was shooting something else with Bradley Whitford. Was playing the art thief if Sadie had been married. Anyway, okay.
Can we get back to something that?
Yeah, please.
Have we finished the cat subject? Let's really get into it.
Well, I think you're, did I overhear you say you're allergic?
I am, yeah.
You're allergic and you have three cats.
I was diagnosed in 2008 as being pretty deathly allergic to cats.
Deathly allergic?
And just at that time, my wife and I were opening a cat clinic. And she's a cat doctor only. That's the only kind of, I mean, she's a veterinarian, so she studied all these animals, but her love is cats, though she just sold her practice. But yeah.
So even if you didn't have three cats at home, she's coming home every day covered in cat hair.
Well, she's not disgusting.
No, I'm not, it's not, how would she avoid that?
Clean room?
Oh, no, the cat's hair, it flies in the air and it lands on you. There's no way to avoid it.
It's true.
So do you take a medication? Do you sneeze?
I did for a while, and then it didn't really do anything. No, I don't know. I've decided to no longer, I think so. I did acupuncture for a while, and then I decided not to be allergic to cats anymore.
Where did they put the needles? For cat allergies, where do they go? Where did they go? On the skull, on the cranium, in the neck? On the chest? Where? Do you remember?
Keep going.
Were you on your stomach or on your back? Were you lying down or sitting up?
I'm never going
to
answer
this. I need you to start answering some questions.
This is the most fun ever.
All right.
Pass.
Well, all right.
I was lying on my back and it was all over. It'd be in my feet, in my ankles, knees, here. And you can hear them go in. Like, have you had it?
Yeah, I have.
When they go in here and here and stuff, you can hear like a little like celery crunch, like a little like.
Yeah. Have you ever had it?
Oh, boy.
Yeah, you can hear it.
Yeah.
It's true.
But it doesn't hurt that much. They're just, isn't great, but.
I had some in my ankles and stuff that, I don't know how chi works, but it felt like my body was like, yeah, get that needle in here. Like it went, and it was briefly painful.
Okay.
Like electric, like.
Well, they do that too. They have electrified ones.
Yeah,
I saw that on Real Housewives. I wouldn't do that.
But the real question I was trying to get back to was...
Oh, are we not there yet?
Yeah, you're right.
You at the top of the show said you've known Mark for 9 years, and Mark scoffed and said,
yeah,
that's
how
not
long
right.
have we known each other? What are you talking about?
I did meet you. Larry Campbell's one of my best friends.
Oh,
and I came to a taping at Paramount with you and Brad Rader and David Krumholtz and John Cryer
and
back
John
then.
Cryer, yeah.
You would never have noticed that.
I guess it wasn't one of the episodes that never aired.
Were there a lot of those?
Oh, because Sam Levine was one of the episodes that never aired.
Really? Pageant.
That's how we met. So yeah, 14 years ago.
Jim Beaver was on that show too.
Jim Beaver, who also does the...
Another thrilling adventure game. So that, that was mean-spirited because there's no way you could possibly have remembered Larry Campbell's nobody friend from Detroit coming to visit the set.
This is all I wanted out of today.
Really?
Yeah, I wanted you to admit that you have flaws. And you just said you were scared to ask your father-in-law for your wife's hand in marriage for 2 hours.
Oh, petrified.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you have known fear. And you just said that what you said was mean-spirited.
Yeah.
I don't think it was, but I feel like you may be human after all.
I promise I am.
Not a Borg?
I'm not saying I'm fully human. I'm saying that originally I started that way.
So you are from Earth.
I'm... Correct, yeah.
Okay. Oh, do it! Come on, do it! Do it!
No.
Do it! Oh, it's good.
Maybe at the end. Hey, nobody knows what that means.
Hey,
nobody
Patrick,
knows.
Would you like to talk about low T?
Oh, Mark.
Oh,
I
please.
Did want to talk to you about this one
Speaking
thing.
Speaking of my fear.
Hold on. Listen. Mark.
Wait.
As men age. What?
I think you're meant to...
talk to them.
Talk to them about low...
Oh, I thought you wanted me to talk to Mark about low testosterone. Guys, it's not funny. As men age, they can experience weight gain, muscle loss, fatigue, trouble sleeping, and decreased sexual performance. Chances are, it's not your fault. It's hormones. After age 25, men can lose as much as 2% of their normal testosterone levels. By age 50, which you are not. Some men are at half the levels they were in their 20s. Additionally, as these levels lower, men's estrogen levels can rise. Estrogen can be linked to fat stored around the belly and the chest. This is why ladies get a belly later on. Men do too, but they shouldn't. This is something that can be stopped. It's because you're producing estrogen, and that's part of the problem with low T. Many testosterone supplements are marketed at 20-year-old gym rat guys, and that's bad news because they're loaded with caffeine and they could be potentially dangerous. So, and I'm not joking around. This is a genuine testosterone support that you can go on, and it's from Regimen. That's not a joke. It was designed by board-certified cardiologist and anti-aging specialist Dr. Robert Burke. It is a safe, natural alternative to the hormones with all the caffeine and the junk in it that you don't want. Oh, and it's also not a hormone replacement therapy. This naturally helps your body produce more testosterone at the same time providing an anti-estrogen component, because you want to do both. You want the male hormones and you want to lower the female hormones. It's been proven effective in restoring testosterone levels naturally while supporting lean muscle mass, improving your sex drive, and enhancing your feeling of well-being. That sounds great. That sounds totally, that's awesome. Low testosterone is like a guy's midlife crisis, or menopause. Like when women go through menopause, that's horrible, and there's hormone replacement therapy, right? But this is not that, this is all natural. So listen, try a 30-day supply of Regimen testosterone support absolutely free. All you have to do is pay the shipping and handling. I don't know how much that is, but it still sounds pretty good, it's absolutely free. Get your free 30-day supply now at repairlowt.com/Kevin or call 1-800-569-8826. That's repairlowt.com/Kevin.
How do you spell repair low T?
Oh, R-E-P-A-R-L-O-W-T.
There's no I in repair?
R-E-P-A-O, there is an I in there.
Okay.
Thank God we pointed that out.
I just want to make the low T part.
You're right.
We should repair and
oh,
then
low.
L-O,
L-O-T.
The letter T.
Repair, R-E-P-A-I-R, low, L-O-W-T.
T, okay, there's a W. L-O, and then the letter T.
Will you spell that as Sadie Doyle, please?
R-E-P-A-I-R-L-O-W-T. .com/Kevin. Or you can call 1-800-569-8826. Fix your testosterone levels.
Well done.
My favorite.
That's the longest ad.
Yeah.
But, you know, they had a lot of information that they wanted to get out
How
there.
Else are they going to get that information out there?
But it is, I mean, I can understand people thinking that it's funny. Testosterone, testicles, estrogen, but that's got to be a drag. That's going to be a drag. Low T.
May I never know.
I hope you won't. I hope you will never know.
And you know what? If you ever have a problem, why don't you go to repairlowt.com?
Yeah. Regimen. From Regimen.
From Regimen.
How will I never ever know how to spell it, though?
Ask Sadie.
Because I've misspelled it twice.
Ask Sadie.gov.
It's a repetition. That's okay. I'm going to ask you some questions.
Please.
You can answer them or you can pass.
This just became an interrogation.
It is, a little bit.
Yeah.
Just because I can. Like, when am I going to have this opportunity again? Well, you can't leave
you
the
have
room.
You have my phone number.
I know, but I can now ask a bunch of ridiculous questions.
Oh, sure.
What? What's wrong?
There's a second.
What's happening?
There's a second ad.
Oh, God. Okay. I'll do the second ad.
Oh, it's on the prompter.
Oh, listeners. Help Kevin Pollak's chat show stay free to download by completing... Stay free to download by completing this short anonymous survey. It will take no more than 5 minutes, and your answers will help match our show with advertisers that best fit the sensibilities of our podcast and its listeners like you. Listeners who complete the survey will be entered in an ongoing monthly raffle to win a $100 Amazon gift card.
Get the fuck out of here.
It's true. We promise not to.
share or sell your email address, and we won't send you an email unless you win. That's nice.
What?
I don't want anyone getting my email.
How could they not do this? Come
Why
on,
would,
people.
Five minutes. You could win a $100 gift card on Amazon.
And you help keep this show free.
Yeah.
It's not free to produce.
Keeps it free. Yeah, those big salaries that you pay yourselves.
I'm going to have to come $500,000 a year doing this.
Listen, just go ahead and do it. I'll do it. And I don't like surveys, but I'm going to do this one because why not? Please go to www.podsurvey.com/Pollack. P-O-L-L-A-K.
I-W.
What? That's www.podsurvey.com/Pollack to take our survey and get a chance to win a $100 Amazon gift card. Thank you. Now, questions. What was the last item that you purchased from the retailer asseenontv.com?
Wow.
An as-seen-on-TV product, what was the last one you purchased? You haven't.
No, I don't know that I have. I'm sorry. I'm
the
not really
cat's
like...
cat's meow.
Which is what?
What's that?
Oh, it's a little toy. It's for cats. It's like
a round piece of vinyl
with a little spinny
wire
thing, and the cat chases it around.
Yeah. You don't
adorable.
Have a cat's meow?
Mm-mm.
Wow. Yeah, what do your cats play with?
Fire.
They play with, they've got 1,000 toys. Are you kidding? I'm married to a cat doctor. but nothing like mechanical. Beth doesn't recommend things. I mean, we've got, sort of things that look like fishing poles.
Right, and they chase after the, what about a laser on the floor?
See, lasers are difficult because people move them too fast and they can cause orthopedic injuries in cats. Because
orthopedic injuries?
Yeah, because like people whip them back and forth and the cat is going to get that bug.
Gets hurt?
Also, if I may.
It seems like you have.
And I will. With the other toys, eventually the cat will catch it and get that gratified feeling of, oh, I did it again.
Yeah. Oh,
with
right.
the laser pointer,
the lasers, they never
catch it.
Yeah.
It's like
so
an
it's
acting defeat, career.
They feel defeated.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like there's no way to avoid
pursuing a career in the arts.
Scent of defeat.
You'll chase the dot all over the room. You'll never really get it.
We're all just cats.
We're all just chasing that laser pointer. Are you in a boy band?
I'm not.
Were you in a boy band?
I fronted a band called Common Rotation for a while.
Ah, that was a boy band. Some cute boys in that band. That's right. I've seen you perform.
I'm absolutely kidding, obviously. There is a band called Common Rotation who are friends of ours.
Yeah, but who are genuine musicians. They don't just dance on stage and, you know, to an electronic beat. Like, that's a boy band. They're not like NSYNC.
They're the furthest thing possible.
Right, exactly. They're real. They're great.
Yes.
They're very gifted.
They're amazing. And they are they're friends. And they allowed me, back in the day when we were doing the Thrilling Adventure Hour at M-Bar, I would ruin their show after our show by heckling them and just commandeering the stage. Yeah.
Have you done that in the last few years?
Mm-mm. We did it a couple times in the Little Room at Largo when we first started doing the Thrilling Adventure Hour there. But it was a different game. It just didn't travel. It didn't translate somehow.
Is there a job or part in a film or television show that you have turned down that you regret, or that you desperately wish you'd gotten and you didn't?
Turned down and regret? No, I'm not really in that position in my career to be saying no to a lot of things. I tested for a number of things that I wish I would have gotten, but I can't say that I'm unhappy with where I am now. But I suppose I can talk.
But you don't have any regrets. You don't feel like, oh.
No, not really. No, I tested for the role of Phil Dunphy on Modern Family opposite Ty Burrell, and I think he's amazing. And I don't like he does a thing that I can't do.
Well, you do things that he can't do.
All the way. he's amazing. I tested for the, on Brooklyn Nine-Nine, I tested for the Charles Boyle role played by my friend Joe Lotrulio, and there's no other Charles Boyle than Joe Lotrulio. I mean, he was meant to have that job. I tested for The Daily Show back in the day, and Rob Ringel got it at that point. So these are all things that would have been nice and lucrative, but no, I don't, obviously I would have liked to have gotten them, but I'm not going to burn down Hollywood.
Good. I'm glad.
What about you, Patch? Have you turned down any roles that you were?
Oh, was
no,
that a
I
leading question? Was
no,
that
I
a leading
turned
question?
Down no, it wasn't
like,
at all.
What about you?
No, I haven't turned down anything. No. I haven't turned down anything. I would like your advice.
That seems ill-advised. Go for it.
Do you picture what? Like, do you have a vision board or hope chest?
Those are
or
two very different
catcher.
Things.
Or a dream catcher.
A hope chest, like do at you, the foot of my bed for when I get married?
Is that what a hope chest is? I didn't know what it is.
Yeah.
No, I mean, do you believe in, oh, I'm going to visualize, I want my life to be this way, or I want to be on this kind of show, or I want to do these kinds of movies, or are you just open to... You know, I feel like we roll along and opportunities, you know, you got nothing for a while and then boom, something comes up and you're excited and you, but I wonder if it's wiser to visualize stuff, I don't know.
I think I'm mostly column B. I mean, I think that it's mostly work begets work and, you know, Hollywood's a very small town and at the end of the day, like, you know, I will deliberately go in for auditions for things that it's like, I'm not right for this. Because it's really not about auditioning for that particular role. It's like, I want to impress these casting directors,
right.
Show them that I'm human and funny and that, you know, I can walk and talk and things and show up on time and what have you. So that 2 years from now, they'll go, we're casting this thing. Who was that guy 2 years ago that was totally wrong for that thing, but was funny and whatever?
Right.
Like, maybe we'll, whatever. So I will do that. But,
good. I do that too, and you're making me feel good that you do the same thing. You're
know
open
you've
to whatever.
You've worked a ton more than I have, right?
No.
Yes, you have.
No. Mine's not as long as this. Nope.
That's what she said.
Look at all this. Oh, that's what she said. Are you bringing that back?
No, you said it.
Mine's not as long as this.
She literally just said it. That's all.
I disagree. I think that you've done more comedy and exciting. I think you've done a lot of really exciting things. I still would prefer if you were a regular on something for a long time that I can watch all the time and maybe binge watch. But I think that's going to happen.
I mean, I just have to go.
Yeah, Jackson, stop turning down all that regular TV work.
I'm not saying he turns down. I think it's difficult to keep your hopes up in a business that can crush you.
Sure.
And make you question yourself.
Sure.
And you, as with French horn and yacht sailing and piano and voiceover and interviewing, you appear to sort of navigate everything very elegantly and you.
Thank you. That's...
People want to work with you. I want to write something for you. Because I find you.
Right now?
Yeah,
sure
I will start writing. I think you're very inspirational and I think you're very, you're just always good at everything and it is a little intimidating.
Thank you.
But not
that's
in a
absurd.
Mean way. You're not a mean person. You're a fabulous person.
Agreed.
did I have a question in there? No.
No, that's very sweet of you. Thank you.
I feel that way.
I feel that way about you. Yeah.
We were talking about hope chests.
So anyway...
he was saying... He made me feel better because what he was saying was, no, I don't visualize. I want X. I want this. I want this kind of... He's open to... You know what?
Sure. I mean,
the possibilities that may arise.
I'm not amazing at the business of our business. Like, I have friends that are far more studied in the rules of SAG contracts and the way that movies are made and how to get in on that stuff. And I don't like doing things I don't like doing. the path that I've, I had no plan. From day one. Like, I went away to college not knowing that I was going to study philosophy and political science and environmental studies happened to become the touch points for my degree because those were the classes that, like, on the 11th, on the eve of my senior year, it was like, I got to make a major out of something. And it was stuff I had taken a lot of because I was interested in it, but I didn't have any plan.
You, at that point, didn't have any plan for what am I going to do when I get out of college? I want to act.
I knew I wanted to go sailing. I knew I wanted to sail.
And you did it for 2 years.
Yeah.
Would you live that way again?
If you could make money, but even as the first mate of the schooner Mercantile in Camden, Maine, I think I made $125 a week.
Whoa!
Yeah, and they don't televise it. That's it, reality show.
Uh-oh.
Schooner Wars.
Schooner Wars!
Trademark pending. That's mine. I don't strategize. I mean, I look at some friends of mine, like I look at some of the people that, as a matter of fact, that they have given us to work with for Thrilling Adventure. Like, I think like, oh, I could stand to have a career like J.K. Simmons or Clark Gregg or some of those guys. You know, like those are guys that I look up to. But I don't.
You also have the same color eyes.
As?
Don't you?
As
those two gentlemen.
I don't know.
Correct?
Moses?
No, I think they all have those blue eyes.
Is that right?
I think so.
Is that right, Sadie?
I'm not sure.
I don't write it on a note and put it under my pillow or whatever.
Have you ever done anything superstitious or sailors
are superstitious.
Thinking or oh yeah?
No, I mean I believe that there's order to the universe. I believe that you can create your own realities and that that if you really set your mind to something and focus on it or whatever that. You can get far closer to bringing it about.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that if you think that you're not able to do something, that you are 100% not able to do that thing, you know?
If you believe that you can't, you can't.
Yeah, if you tell yourself that you're not able, which I think is something that I learned in the course of improvisation. Like, improv is something that everybody should do, and is something that it is my faith. It is, you know, what I believe in. It is allowed, a billion terrible auditions or, you know, improv scenes or whatever to happen, and for you to be able to do that and get up after it and go like, that was terrible. I'm not terrible. I'm not a bad person. I'm not dumb or not funny. That just didn't happen to go well. Let's look at why. Let's just try again or whatever.
Hmm.
You have a background in improv, it's my understanding, with my friends Evan Gore and Dave Rozowski.
I studied with them, yeah. Yeah. I've done a couple, you know, improvised scenes here and there, but I haven't done it on stage with a group, like a Herald or...
Oh, really?
No. I've done ASCAT where you do the monologue and then they improvise. But taking an improv, those classes at Bang with Evan and Rozowski, I feel like I learned more about acting with the tools I learned from improv
positively
than I did from most of my actual acting classes.
I've heard a lot of actors say that, yeah.
Because it's, and I think I made the mistake that I think most people do, when they're first trying to improvise, they're trying to be funny.
Yeah.
And my teachers were saying, stop, it sounds like you're trying to do a stand-up act. Just tell an honest story. Just be honest about something.
Yeah.
And we all, you know, have similar fears or desires or weaknesses or needs, and so that's what we recognize in each other, I believe. Am I saying this properly? Improv works if it's the truth.
Sure, yeah, absolutely. That which, you know, the one of the, I don't know if this is a comedy axiom or just a life axiom, but that which is most personal is most universal. Like, you think that you're the only one in the world that, does something flushes the toilet that way.
Mm-hmm.
But if you were to put that out there and really confess it, and not try to amplify it, not try to augment it, not try to, you know, gussy it up, just tell your honest truth, like, it's gonna resonate with people in the audience, because you're not alone.
Yeah.
What's a toilet?
What's a toilet? Good heavens.
Hey, do you put the toilet paper roll in the, you know, wall space with the paper coming out, folding over the top and down, or underneath?
Well, I'm not an animal, so obviously coming over the top in front.
Right. Why do people do it coming out of the bottom?
Will you please ask my wife that?
It's counterintuitive. I was going to ask.
Why.
Does she do it the other way?
Wait, you know the answer, don't you?
What?
Yeah. What is it, Sam?
What?
What's your system?
You do it under.
I absolutely do not do it under. I do it overhand style like you're supposed to.
Okay.
Thank you.
The
okay.
only reason to do it underhand style is if you have cats.
Yeah, they do.
Oh!
That will unroll that shit.
That part is correct. Yeah.
That's the only Snug reason to do it underhand. So if I walk into a house and I see underhand toilet paper and there's no cat in there, I'm out.
No, you don't.
I leave. I walk out of the house. I don't even flush. I just leave.
Have you turned it over? Because I've taken it out and turned it the right way.
At someone else's house?
Yeah, and I stopped doing it because I realized that was a little rude.
You have a problem. Yeah.
I stopped doing it. Now I don't do it. I have friends who do it under, and I leave it alone. I don't understand it, but I leave it alone.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to go out on a limb. If we have any viewers or listeners who have underhand style toilet paper rolls in their homes with no cats, just
Paget will come over and
doesn't
change it.
Doesn't make sense.
Just don't.
Doesn't
just
make sense.
Leave us behind. We there's no spot for us in your life. Yeah, that's right.
What happened?
I got a wow from the control booth.
I thought you were going to say, if there are any people watching this that are still watching this.
Yep.
I'm doing a bad job.
You're doing great.
A great job. Can I tell you what I think you might want right now?
Well, tell me.
Is a little break for a very fun game called Who Tweeted.
Let's do it.
Roll the thing.
Are we going to watch something?
No, they're going to roll a little intro.
Celebrities have so much to say.
Who tweeted?
Is the game we're going to play.
Ooh, no.
Okay. Would you care? Where's the thing? The champagne.
Oh, I have it right here. Here, go ahead.
You okay, do all right. I'm gonna talk about the game for a second.
Oh, my God.
This is a very fun game, which you're going to enjoy. And the two of you are going to be playing against one another.
Okay.
Okay, so the name of the game.
Is it physical?
That's later. That's later.
Okay.
The name of the game is Who Tweeted? And that's correct. And in honor of you, Marc Evan Jackson, our guest today, Jamie, the creator of Who Tweeted, has come up with the Parks and Rec related.
Oh, I'm on a show.
I know.
Yeah, okay.
I just didn't ask you about it yet. Okay.
So, as such, I'm going to read a series of 8 tweets,
okay,
one at a time. All of these tweets were authored by either Aziz Ansari,
okay,
Retta,
sure,
or Jim O'Hare.
Nice.
3 wonderful supporting players from the Parks and Recreation.
I don't know that Aziz is supporting. Keep going.
Okay. Okay. Well, unless you're Amy, technically.
Yes, I suppose. Okay.
Yes, right? Would Aziz ever be nominated in the leading actor category for that show?
I suppose you're right.
All right.
Don't they still have actor and actress?
I think so.
They do.
It's not one,
they do.
Yeah.
But just a quick pint of champagne. Unofficially, I agree with you.
Yeah.
All right. So here's how it goes. I will read a tweet. Once you feel that you know who authored it, you buzz in by saying your first name. That would be either Paget or Mark or Jackson or whatever you want to call yourself.
I'm playing Mark in this?
Yep.
Okay.
Your first name.
I will point to you, and then you'll have 3 seconds to say either Aziz, Retta, or Jim.
Okay.
If you ring in and you get it right, you get yourself 5 points. You ring in and you get it wrong, you lose 3. At the end of 8 tweets, unless we have a tie, one of you is walking away
with a
sweet-ass $20 bill. That's right. $20. There is money on the line here.
Can't wait.
A prize, Uber money.
Are you ready to play Who Tweeted Parks and Rec Edition?
Yes.
Yes.
Mark, yes.
Tweet number 1. Just heard Craigie Ferg is leaving Late Late Show. He took my talk show virginity. He was gentle, kind, and I heard from him the next day.
Mark, Aziz.
Ooh, I'm sorry, no. Jim O'Hare.
Whoa.
Jim O'Hare.
You lost 3 points. You are in a
deficit. You know what I got fooled by?
3.
Craigie Ferg is his Twitter handle.
It is his Twitter handle.
And I thought it was Aziz being
Aziz
Street.
Yep. Keep in mind, the way I read them is not necessarily
not
the way
improve.
They were intended to be read.
Okay.
Tweet number 2. I will never accept your invite to play Candy Crush.
Paget! Retta!
That is correct.
Yeah, nice.
That is correct.
I don't know what Candy Crush is.
Then you've made a good
but
guess.
But I feel like she is a woman who knows what she will and will not do. I like her a lot.
Okay.
She is that.
She beat the hell out of me on Hollywood Game Night.
Did she?
Oh.
I didn't see that episode.
No.
I'm sorry.
You can watch it on Hulu Plus.
Oh, all right.
It says in here that I have Hulu Plus.
That was the one thing they got right.
Tweet.
Not their dossier, mine.
Mm.
Tweet number 3.
Damn.
Bad news. Forgot to put the shower gel in my gym bag, so I had to shower with shampoo. Good news. Now all my hairs are manageable.
Mark Aziz.
I'm so sorry, Mark.
What?
Also, yeah. Retta.
Really?
Also, Retta.
That's bizarre.
Yeah. And
I was
going to
say Jim. I wasn't going to say
Yeah.
That's all right. That's all right. Don't worry. This is not an insurmountable hole. Just because it's plus 5 to minus 6 doesn't mean the game's anything but getting interesting. We've had spectacular comebacks
mm-hmm.
and spectacular failures. Tweet number 4.
Yes.
Mrs. Doubtfire 2? Excuse me, dear. I'm going to throw a party with a petting zoo and blast Jump Around.
Marc Aziz.
That is correct!
Yeah. Oh,
I didn't, I couldn't pull the trigger.
You knew he had to be in there somewhere.
I couldn't pull the trigger.
It's all right.
It was a game of odds.
Getting right. closer. Tweet number 5. Yesterday, I saw Corey Feldman at the post office and Matt LeBlanc at Ralph's, paren, grocery store. Thought the world should know. Smiley face, hashtag, nice cars.
Marc, Jim O'Hare.
Oh, that's correct. Yeah. We got ourselves a game.
Oh, shoot. Okay. Oh, boy.
See,
grocery
now
store.
It's +5 to
grocery
+4.
Store.
See, that's where we're at now.
Why?
Yeah.
Who would
it's
you
a
call
one-point game.
No, I would call it that. I don't think that Retta or Aziz would parenthetically explain to the rest of the country what Ralph's is.
That's cute. Good.
That's fair. Solution. I'm glad
deductive.
I read it.
Really
I'm glad
good.
I read it.
Very good. Like, okay, let's have
it's a one-point game. This is a one-point game.
Yeah. So
he's 1 point ahead of me.
No, 1 point behind
oh,
you.
Oh, let's go.
Yeah. Tweet number 6. Catching up on Olympics. Did Scott Hamilton just say, quote, that was a clean camel toe, close quote? I keep rewinding. I think he did. LOL. Hashtag, I'm a child.
Marc, Jim O'Hare.
That is correct!
Yeah.
Oh, no, taking a commanding 9-point lead. 9 points to 5 points. Paget, you gotta...
I'm ready,
this
I'm
is
ready.
Still anyone's game. It's
I'm
only
ready,
a four-point differential here.
All right.
Tweet number 7 of 8. Just unfollowed all babies and dogs on social media. Hashtag productive day.
Paget, Aziz.
That is correct! Oh, no.
Wow.
Oh, guys, it's coming down to this.
Where are we?
It's the 8th and final tweet. It's a 1-point game.
Winner takes all.
It's 10 points to 9 points.
Oh, winner takes all.
This might as well be a tiebreaker.
Okay.
You ring and you
it
get
is,
it right,
it
you win, you ring
is.
And you get it wrong, you lose.
I believe I said winner takes all.
You did. You did.
You did. Yeah. I'm just saying if you're wrong.
What I meant was the person who gets the next one right.
Right.
Yeah.
Or.
Well, if someone gets it wrong,
if you're
they lose
get it
3
wrong,
points, so they lose 2.
You're going to lose 2 many points. Look, it's very exciting. It's very exciting is the bottom line.
Okay, let's do it. Let's do it.
The 8th and final tweet.
Are we sure we want to do this?
Should we just call it a draw?
No. Just
tweet
rip it in half.
Number 8. The smell of urine downtown is particularly pungent today. Am I to assume a rash of jellyfish attacks in the greater Los Angeles area?
Marc Aziz.
Oh, sorry, it was Retta.
Was it Retta? That's tougher than it should be.
It was Retta.
Congratulations.
And Paget, that is how you win Who Tweeted.
Thank you!
Now.
Celebrities have so much to say.
Who tweeted?
Is the game that we just played.
Who wrote the song? Who wrote the jingle?
That's this young man right
nice.
There.
Nice.
Great.
Nice, Kenny.
Singing those fine tunes.
is that your voice? Who tweeted?
Yes, of course.
Pretty good.
That's pretty great.
Yeah, I like audio listeners.
I like it a lot. Marc.
Please.
I would like you to tell me about your favorite acting role to date.
Hmm.
Not that one is better than another, but
sure.
maybe something where you learned something you didn't expect to learn, or something that was very, very exciting to do, or terrifying, and then you slayed the dragon.
Okay. It's one that probably very few people saw. It was one of my most fun things in recent memory was a Fox Digital web series called Suit Up. And we did 2 seasons of it, and I play a character called Jim Dunnigan, who was kind of a political fixer, kind of a communication specialist, like a guy that would manage crises. And it was really a ball because we did, the storyline is that he gets fired, does not pick up a campaign with a senator or a congressperson to sort of manage their campaign. So he's kind of down and out, he's been fired from a couple of jobs, and he gets hired by a fictional southern big university called Glory University to come and handle one of their NCAA sports scandals. And Barry Corbin plays the chancellor of this university. And it was a great chance to work with him. And it was also So I was the star of this thing. It was largely improv-based. It was a very funny script, but they wanted me to put it in my own words, which I love doing. That's a blessing.
Right.
And it's fortunately the way a lot of work seems to be going these days, that they want it, you know, like, I get hired these days because I improvise. Like, I get hired because, you know, you're able to react to things in the room and mm-hmm. handle it.
So now this was a web series?
Two seasons of a web series, yeah.
Can they be seen?
They can, I think, yeah.
Suit up.
And it was it was very low budget by television or film comparisons, and so we were shooting a lot. We were shooting 12 pages a day, and really running and gunning. And director was a guy named Chris Leone, and just phenomenal. And the cinematographer was a guy named Bryce Fortner, who was the shooter for Portlandia. Uh-huh. And so he's very good at moving quickly and setting up. So it's just, we shot like 11 days and made effectively a feature film in 11 days.
Wow.
And it was really a ball.
Have you done a lot of that? I mean, like feature films that are shot 6 days a week, couple of weeks, boom?
I've done probably more than that, than anything else, like smaller movies or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It makes when you
shoot. You've done some big movies.
Have I?
Yeah, I think so.
I love that the address for the studio we're at is at the top of that page.
22 Jump Street.
Yeah.
I'm not in that.
No.
Kings of Summer?
Yeah.
Oh, Kings of Summer.
Kings of Summer?
Great. The Baby Makers.
Mm-hmm.
Karaoke Man.
Not a big movie.
Brick Novak's Diary. That's a short.
It's a short, but it's a big short.
Good News Oklahoma. That's a short.
That's, yeah.
Drones.
Yeah.
With our friends.
Drones.
Mm-hmm. Starring.
Senor Levine.
C'est la vie. Yeah.
C'est la vie. Uh-huh. Senor Levine.
That's my name.
Transformers Revenge of the Fallen.
Yes.
$200 million budget. And it has grossed, according to IMDb, $402 million, doubling what it cost. What's that like being on a movie like that? Because I haven't done it.
Oh, I credit myself. I was just talking about this last night, actually, with Aaron Ginsberg and Ben Blacker and company. I was very briefly, I shot one day on Transformers 2 Revenge of the Fallen. I'm in the movie. All of my lines got cut. All of my words got cut. But I am distinctly visible in a, it's about an hour into the movie, I think, and I'm in a like a video conference scene. I play the chairman of, or the commander of U.S. Central Command. I play I think, 3 or 4-star Navy admiral.
Wow.
And all my words got cut, but I'm totally visible. And then they lifted that footage and put it in Transformers 3, Dark of the Moon. Because I remember...
Wait, do you get paid for that?
Not initially. I had to call SAG, and it they'd worked it out.
Yeah, they have to pay you, I think.
They did, yeah. But
Good for you, Colin Hanks, calling SAG.
Well, yeah, money.
Yeah, just ask Crispin Glover.
Yeah, he won that.
Colin Hanks texted me from the theater and was like, hey, nice job in Transformers 3. And I was like, buddy, I'm not in Transformers 3.
And that's how you found out? Because
yeah.
Colin told you? Yeah, you are, buddy?
And he's like, I'm in the theater. You are, I promise.
The larger problem with this story is, why was Colin Hanks seeing Transformers 3 in theaters?
During the day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And texting you.
Oh, we're buddies.
They're too young.
No, but I mean, when someone takes out a phone and texts,
I know,
in
but
the
it was during
theater,
the. I have to believe he was the only
maybe
person
he got
in that
a
theater.
Screener.
For your consideration.
Sure.
This afternoon for lunch, Transformers 3.
Sound effects? I bet it's nominated for
sound design.
Yeah. Sound design.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's tough stuff, that. All that.
I'll support that.
Did it win
sound.
For? Because that's the sound of Transformers.
So you've done more, I've done more indie films, and do you have...
I think you've done more work, period.
I don't think that you're right about that.
You've been doing this a while, you know that, yeah. Right? And you've been very successful for a long time.
I am older than you.
Do you need to be reminded
of
this?
I've got that on myself.
I'm not sure that's correct.
Well, here's
you've
the thing.
You've literally stopped working for almost 20 years.
No. The last 2 years, I've done a couple of guest things here and there,
mm-hmm.
and I've done a couple of pilots that didn't go, but... it turns out, when you're lucky enough to have hoarded money from one long job and then decided to wait for something you really want to do,
mm-hmm.
you wait a while.
Oh, okay.
You know what I mean?
I don't.
As far as, you don't say yes to everything.
I understand the words you're saying.
You don't say yes to absolutely everything.
Only of late have I not said yes to absolutely.
Me too, only
yeah.
of late.
Yeah.
And it's a little scary because it's
it is
been...
Scary.
years
yeah.
without. Otherwise, why am I drinking champagne in the middle of the afternoon on Sunday? I'll tell you why, because I do it every Sunday.
That's what Sunday
because
for.
I can.
Sure.
Yeah. That's what Sundays are for.
Is it?
There you go.
So that's okay? Day drinking now? We're okay with that?
The crew's applauding.
If it's Sunday after 11, there's no reason not to be day drunk.
So 11 is when
11
I should wait
the,
till 11.
I should begin waiting. Okay, so, I should begin okay. waiting until 11.
Wait till 11. Then
bring
you're okay. No, it is a little unnerving to, you know, not work. But I think that's sort of just how this gig is.
I think a friend of mine, a director friend of mine, has said that the only power that the artist has in Hollywood is the word no. And as a you know, as somebody that's up and coming and hungry and whatever, you're and an improviser, you are taught to say yes. You're taught to go like, sure, but this could be great. Yeah, let's see what this is. Mm-hmm. And I do think that you arrive at a transition where you have to start going like, when I do this, it doesn't make me feel good. I'm not going to do that anymore, you know, whether that's a lifestyle thing or a particular kind of job. And I just in the past year or so have started to go like, I don't love that kind of work. I think I'm not going to do it anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a good feeling to be able financially to do that.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's a luxury.
As opposed to
it's a luxury to have that
having
option.
To, because I took nothing against any of the work that I've done. I've been really happy to do everything that I've done, but I didn't have a criteria. It was, oh, I could learn this. I could meet this person. I could figure out how to act in this medium.
Sure.
I did everything. I took everything.
I can pay rent for the next month.
I can pay,
there's
yeah,
that.
Exactly.
That.
I took everything because I wanted to get better and learn and mm-hmm. and work with other people who would have good advice and it would be exciting and fun. And now I'm offered a lot of the same parts
sure.
that are what I've done before, cop and grieving mom.
Yeah.
And I don't want to do that right now, unless it was something great.
Sure.
That really was it was a
grieving,
unique take on that character. You know what I mean?
Grieving cop mom.
Grieving cop mom. No, I haven't been offered that.
Okay.
See, that's a mashup.
I'll write it.
There we go.
In Braille.
Grieving cop mom. But
I know exactly
are you,
what you mean.
Offered the same parts over and over again?
Sure. And so, I think you don't even realize until you begin to assemble it. Like I just had a friend put together a new reel for me, and it's like, wow, I wear a lot of suits. Okay. You know, like I play a lot of attorneys mm-hmm. and judges and doctors and professors and things. It's a lot of suit and tie, shirt and tie, sweater vest and tie kind of thing. And again, like that's fine.
Do you think that's self-actualized? Because you are a dandy in real life.
I'm a tremendous dandy.
No, you dress extremely well. You enjoy suits.
Not Paul F. Tompkins well, but yeah, I do all right.
No, you do. You do. Paul's more of a three-piece suit man.
I suppose, yeah.
Are you more of a two-piece?
I am, yeah.
Yeah. But you're a bow tie.
Mm-hmm.
When was the last time you wore a long tie?
I wear long ties a lot for work,
oh.
but not at all for myself. I don't.
You're a bow tie man.
Mm-hmm. Got yeah, it. Since high school.
Mm-hmm.
I saw you.
High school.
I saw him in jeans recently, and I was
whoa.
Like, whoa,
whoa,
wow,
whoa.
Whoa.
I believe you mean denim trousers.
Very nice.
Oh, Mr. Jackson, weird running
but
into
you
at
regret.
The Target.
I mean, it's possible that that's what did I miss? What did you do?
It's when you run into a teacher. Out in real life,
oh.
and you see them not wearing professional clothing.
Right.
It's always yeah. weird. You're like, oh, hello, Mr. Johnson, or whatever it is.
Jackson.
It's been a long time
in this
since
I
had
in this one, I was it was me running into Mr. Jackson at the Target.
I totally get it.
I'm glad I had to explain it.
Have you ever had therapy? What? You don't have to answer that.
Where the hell did that come from?
No, I have. And I ran into my therapist out in the world, and it was, I didn't know what to do.
Did you instinctively lay down?
No, it's not that kind of thing. Why? Do you lie down in your therapy?
Isn't that how it works? I guess I haven't had it.
Any kind of therapy? Couples counseling.
Anything? Yeah, couples,
I mean, that's
sure.
you know, that's good. We should do that. People should do that. I think
people should do that. I think marriage is, you know, wonderful. But you like, I do think that it's good to have a third party from time to time. To like chat about relationship issues and mm-hmm. just to have an objective third party to go, oh, well, that's crazy.
Like, now, when you first went into couples counseling, whether it was with Beth or with someone else, I'm not going to press. Did you think, oh yeah, I'll go to a couples counselor because she's going to find out she's totally wrong and I'm totally right?
I think we were both going for that reason, and okay, we did it like twice. And the dude was a maniac, and so we
what
never.
You mean a maniac? What did he do?
It's just odd.
What?
Oh, I think a lot. I think the better part of people that go into the social and psychological sciences are mental cases.
You think so?
I know so.
What was that deep intake of breath?
That was a lot of wind sucked up.
I was both yawning, but also nodding in agreement.
Yawning? Thanks, Sam.
It was not a yawning of boredom. It was a yawning of
oxygen
lack of
deprivation.
Sleep and oxygen deprivation.
Oh, what did you do last night?
Nothing crazy, but
day drinking.
Didn't get a lot of sleep.
Didn't get enough oxygen.
But no, I agree. It does attract mentally
unstable people. You think that, like a physician healed thyself, you think that the mental health workers are genuinely, are generally bananas? Well, that's what you just said.
It's not.
They're a little touched.
Let me just.
I'm curious. I don't know. I haven't. Have I missed this? This is a common knowledge?
No. Here's the thing. I support mental health. I think it's tremendous. And I think it's wildly necessary for
big fan of sanity, Sam.
However, I want you to imagine if you were an orthopedist, and so you want to help heal bone problems with your patients. Uh-huh. But imagine if a patient came in and was like, there's something wrong with all the bones in my shoulder and my arm, but I don't know what it is, and I need you to guess. And you can't take x-rays or anything. You have to have that kind of madness. Because that's what you're really doing when you go to see a mental health professional, is there's no x-ray they can take. The best that they can do is talk to you and through your neuroses make their best educated guess as to what's really the problem.
And that's if you, as the patient, are being 100% honest as well.
Exactly.
Sure.
Yep.
So that's what I think it attracts, like stand-up comedy attracts like a weird person who's like, I want to get out there.
Sounds like a really good documentary. Called Misery Loves Comedy.
Indeed.
That's right.
And so Misery Loves Medicine is the psychiatrist documentary. It's if
I suppose. I mean, there obviously, if you require mental health help, please seek out mental health help.
That's what I'm saying.
But I think that there's probably a 99% of those people are therapeutically valid, but. I do think, like, I remember when I was in college at Calvin and Hobbes, that some friends of mine that were in, like, that were like, I'm going to be a psychologist. It's like, you are the one that needs us.
The last person.
Yeah, you're the last person.
Look at it. I see.
Like, these are people that have had hang-ups. The issues with the dude that Beth and I talked to twice or three times was, like, he took his shoes off and loudly crunched corn nuts during our meetings and stuff. It was odd.
I don't think, are you allowed to eat? Especially crunchy food in therapy? If you're the therapist?
I haven't studied psychology.
That seems weird. No, not psychology. It was
business acumen.
Business acumen. Business acumen. And what drew you to... You already said, though, you didn't really know what you wanted to do. So mm-hmm. That's why...
Still don't
know. And then you just go... What do you mean you still don't know? You know what you're doing.
Yeah, no, I know what I'm doing.
Do you want to do something else?
No, I like this. This is fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're going to stick with this.
Yeah.
Would you ever give it up and live on a cruise ship playing piano and French horn with your wife and no cats, satisfying a number of things?
No.
Okay.
That sounds terrible.
Okay. You went on the cruise, though.
So no, I didn't.
Oh, you didn't do it either. That's right. We were texting each other.
No, we were texting about.
That's right. Yeah. I didn't do it either. Have you been on a cruise?
No, I've never been. I've never been on like a cruise ship cruise. I'm not certain I could handle it.
I don't want to.
I don't know if I could do it.
No.
Everybody reports Acker and Blacker, who hate most things, got mm-hmm. back and were like, "This is really fun." They had a ball on
that
the Jonathan Colton.
That's shocking.
I know. They despise most things. They just don't feel like things are for them or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, they loved it. Everybody, Paul F. Tompkins went on it on mm-hmm. the Jonathan Colton cruise.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's a week or so, 5 days
yeah.
or something. And
they went to Jamaica?
I think so. They loved it.
And
everybody,
yeah.
to a person.
Good.
Sarah Watkins, Sean Cooper, Todd Cooper, like they loved it. Yeah.
What would be the worst job that you could possibly have? Like, what do you think is the worst job in the world? Would you you would kill yourself before you did this job? Maybe that's a little. But
for me, it would involve like if somebody said you have to do your taxes every day for 8 hours. Like if it involved reading things and trying to determine what some government-issued form meant for, you know, what number or series of numbers were to go in these forms or whatever.
Like, that would not be for you.
I don't like homework. I don't like...
But there are people who maybe love it.
Oh, certainly there
are. If you were a CPA?
Oh, thank God there are. Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, I have people that I work with for my own stuff that, thank God, they know that stuff and are good at it and can go, that's the wrong form, this is the right form or whatever. Like, that's the stuff that drives me crazy. My wife and I just started a nonprofit to teach improv free of charge.
Oh, that's right, I read that. Tell me more about this.
It's called
I should have asked you about this before.
There's time. Well, we only have 3 more hours to sneak this in. It's called the Detroit Creativity Project, and we both love the city of Detroit and want to give back, and as well as a lot of my friends that, you know, Keegan Michael Key and Larry Joe Campbell and that whole gang that came from Detroit.
They're from,
We love Detroit and want to give back, and so we started this nonprofit to offer arts education in the public schools.
That's great.
It's getting cut everywhere, but Detroit is particularly bad, and Detroit is particularly in need. And so we started with improv because that's where we all come from, and I think improv offers a great set of life skills for confidence building and, you know, self-esteem and communication skills, and it just takes a lot of the fear out of approaching any situation in life. Like, we all improvise at all times. Like, when you are going to a grocery store or wherever, like, you're improvising. You don't know there's no script. You're interacting in an unscripted and unplanned situation. And to start with games, kind of like Whose Line Is It Anyway kind of games with these students, like, it can really open up their minds to a lot. And it's a very powerful tool. It's a really wonderful thing, and it's a good foothold for the arts in the schools, which, you know, all the funding has been cut. So we've been doing this for since 2011, I guess, is when we first started doing it. But we just recently incorporated and have filed for our 501c3 tax exempt status as our own entity. And the paperwork to do so is
Byzantine. Yeah, it sounds like exactly
Byzantine.
What you don't want to do.
Oh, it's the worst thing. But my wife is one of those people who can. My wife wouldn't have needed teachers in college. They could have just given her the textbooks and she could have read them all and come back 4 years later and gone, got it, cool, take the test, and done well. I may as well leave those books there and go fishing.
That's not true.
It is. I can't do it. If, like, I could learn anything in the world. I could be an astronaut if you showed me how to do it and we talked about it. But if you were like, go read this big, thick book, I'd be like, you know what? I'm not going to do that.
But do you read for pleasure?
Almost not at all.
Fiction? Nothing. Magazines?
Magazines. I'm trying. I don't know. I read very slowly. So I read. And this is true of whether I'm reading fiction or I read as though I'm hearing a book on tape, as though I'm hearing my own voice narrated at this pace, which takes forever.
Huh.
It sounds amazing.
Good. Have you done books on tape?
I haven't.
No. Oh, I feel like you should.
I suppose I should. Yeah.
Could you read all of the books in my home on tape for me?
It would take like 15 years.
I only have 2 books.
Oh, I don't.
I have The Joy of Cooking and the Bible.
Oh, really?
Oh, the Joy of Cooking.
Rombauer and Becker and the Bible.
Like the two longest.
I am not reading that Bible again.
You know, I tried to read the Bible once that was in a hotel room because I didn't bring a book. And I was shooting a movie or something and just alone in the hotel room and not with the TV. Maybe there wasn't a TV.
And the King James Gideon Bible wasn't
God,
a thing?
I couldn't do it. The whole first few pages is 700-year-old, he begat a begat. It was so boring.
It's a lot of begatting.
And I think I got the Bible for dummies because I wasn't raised religiously.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think I got through that either. I feel like it's something I should know.
Is there a Cliff's Notes or?
Maybe there's children's Bible.
I can summarize it for you.
No, I know the children's stuff, probably. Yes, summarize.
Don't be a dick.
Oh,
that's why I'm fine with it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's pretty good.
But that's generally what most religions are saying, aren't they?
Yeah,
most?
But then what are they fighting about?
I don't know.
We only have 3 more hours.
Is that true?
No.
I can see you shaking your head, yeah, over there.
Kenny Mark! Wants to break the record, I can tell.
He wants to break the record?
What is the record? What is the Kevin Pollak's Chat Show record?
Is it
Landis
3 hours?
248?
251. Who was that?
John Landis.
Wow.
I will filibuster this motherfucker so hard.
Oh, life and politics, Mark. Yes or no?
No. In theory, sure, but...
There's a lot of reading required.
Yeah, a lot of reading probably.
Is there?
Because
look,
AIDS.
Is there now?
AIDS, read to
I don't have AIDS.
Thank God. That would have been really prime.
Is that what you're asking?
Do you have AIDS?
You really know how to do it. You sucker me in with cats, and then you go, have you had therapy?
You could.
Do you have AIDS?
Are you a dog man at heart?
No.
Living a lie?
No. I love dogs, but cats are where it's at. Cats are the cool kids. Yeah.
I got nothing.
Really?
I can't think of anything right now.
Maybe try some questions from our viewers.
Yeah, we have the T5s or the viewer questions. Or you brought that weird hourglass and you haven't used it yet.
You insisted they give you an hourglass?
I did. I asked them because I thought that we would take turns because I wanted you to teach me how to interview. I wanted to see your NPR affiliate interviewing skills.
Do you want to see it? Here it comes.
Yeah.
You hosted a talk show called The Paget Show in the 90s in San Francisco.
Yeah.
Talk about that.
That was a long time ago. It's a long time ago.
You know you hosted 65 episodes of a 1:30 a.m.
65 episodes?
Then moved to 1 a.m.
What are you doing? How did you know? Did you watch my Kevin Pollak? Ah, sneaker.
Yeah.
All right. What is something, this is from Valerie Martin.
This is how we do it, with the tweets or the faces, booths.
This is how we. Oh, you said you were going to stop me from singing.
What? I
almost got some Belle Biv DeVoe out there, right?
You almost did.
That's
but
not Belle Biv DeVoe.
Did you say?
Isn't it?
Faces Buchas?
Faces Buchas, yeah.
Is that Jewish?
It sounds that way.
Hold on.
Is that Yiddish?
Valerie Martin at Val Martin on Twitter. She said, "What is something that you know now that you wish you knew when you were first starting out as an actor?"
Oh, okay. First of all, that 2 things, I guess. One, that there's more to auditioning than memorizing the sides, memorizing the script. Like, I think your job in the room is to really prove to the people that you have any inkling of what your character did the moment before those words began, and what that person might do after that person leaves the room. Because very often I in the course of teaching improv and things, and you would sometimes go through these things, and people would go like, yeah, nailed it, memorized it. And it's like, well, yeah, but I don't know what kind of day your guy's having. I don't know what kind of day he's going to have when he leaves or whatever. So you just have to offer something, like, you have to bring something unique to each role that you're auditioning for. And the thing I mentioned earlier, I feel very strongly about, and that is that you're not auditioning for the role that you're auditioning for that day. You know, like people beat themselves up and like, because this happens too, that you'll go to an audition and you'll go and it'll be me and, you know, 6'5" black men, or me and, 300-pound 5'8" men, and you go in the room and you're like, man, I am not right for this. Like, they're obviously looking for this kind of guy, which I'm not. Why am I even here? And people get very in their heads and beat themselves up. Like, before they ever go into audition, mm-hmm. I was just like, this is not going to go well, and which will absolutely become the case.
Mm-hmm.
So your job is to realize that you're probably not going to get the job that you're auditioning for. Like, the stakes are immensely against you. And so to, with that in mind, go in and do what you feel like doing. Mm-hmm. Do and do what you do well, show yourself in the best possible light, knowing that you can't leave and wait for the phone to ring, because it's not going to. Like, mm-hmm. my father sold insurance, and he used to say that it would take 100 calls to land 10 appointments to make one sale. And I feel like auditioning probably has a similar kind of ratio, that you're going to go in for a billion things, and if you land 1% of them, you're probably doing all right.
Yeah.
You know?
And you said there was another piece of advice.
Those two. So the, more than memorizing the sides.
Oh, the necessarily auditioning for that.
You're not auditioning for the role you're auditioning for that day. You're auditioning for roles further down the
future.
The line.
Yeah. I agree. Karen at KarenKaren82 on Twitter When are you and Paget Brewster going to do a TV show together?
You're welcome. Is this not television?
Oh, we did it! We're kind of...
This can be viewed on a television if you hook up your computer.
So boom! There you go.
Take that, Chromecast.
What is that? Apple TV. There you go.
That's TV.
That's TV.
Apple TV. That's where I watch most of the stuff I watch.
But your point is taken, Karen 82. We should write something. We should develop something for the twos of us.
How's my part?
About something.
Nah, never mind.
It's in turnaround.
JSLO21 at JSLO21 Twitter. What's it like to work and be friends with Paget? I don't want to know.
I do. I'll tell you.
How am I different from working versus hanging out?
How are you different?
Me, yeah. What's it like work? What's it like work?
Well, I don't know.
This shouldn't be about me. I don't know why I read that out loud.
It's about you. No, it's not that. I don't know that I can answer that one, though, because I haven't worked with you like in the context of film and television. Like, I think...
Yeah, we've worked together doing Thrilling Adventure.
Kirsten Vangsness could answer this question well. Mm-hmm. We've worked together doing Thrilling Adventure, but that's kind of a hang. You know, like,
it's a hang. It's very also, we very rarely do scenes together. Mm-hmm. So we're on stage at separate times.
It's true.
You know, I can field this one because, Paget and I worked on...
The Trouble with
Normal.
Together 14 years ago.
Yeah.
And
she won't remember.
And socially, she's great. But when you work with her, the second AD will come up to you and tell you beforehand not to address her directly or look her in the eye.
That's utterly untrue. Have either of you worked with someone who did that?
No.
I heard David Caruso was like that.
Oh.
And I wanted to be on that show so bad just to guest on that show so I could have my own story when he was CSI Miami.
Mm-hmm.
And they canceled it right at the beginning of my 2-year dry spell.
What bothers me is that on some sets, what I have seen is someone from the AD department will tell the background.
Oh.
Under no circumstances are you to talk to the actors, don't look at them, do not try to engage them.
Yeah.
And that's strictly coming from the AD department. Because they'll say that, and then the background will often think, oh, that movie star's an asshole. Mm-hmm. And he had nothing to do with that being said.
Wow.
It was not run past him. Huh. They just do that on their own.
Yeah, and I think that's something that... I've never run into it, but I would think that it'd be better to let it become a problem briefly of, like, somebody going, can I take a picture with you or whatever, like when they're about to roll or what have you. But no, I don't.
Nobody would do that. I don't think anyone would.
I believe your story about David Caruso 1,000%.
I've heard things. I don't know. I didn't see it firsthand. I had heard that he was very difficult and I wanted to see it for myself verify it or not.
We had the same voice agent for a while and he came into the office once and no one cared, and then we all got yelled at later by the owner of the agency for, making direct eye contact with them. So I guess I have had that.
Ooh,
yeah, and it was like,
it has happened.
I believe that story.
But you weren't working with him.
No, I was waiting to go into a booth and record some.
And you got in trouble
for doing nothing, for not caring, I suppose.
Not caring. Well, that's rude. Well, I think I know the answer to this.
What's that?
Rebecca Lawson, at, bless you, Rebecca, at WinePlease78 on Twitter. Will Sparks ever find a love interest?
Sparks but, Nevada, my yeah, character from the Thrilling Adventure Hour.
Sparks is... Red Plains Rider is...
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's had a number. I think, though, that I believe that I know that they are going to introduce a new old love interest. So the Red Plains Rider, played by Busy Phillips, has been a love interest for some time. Rebecca Rose Rushmore was a love interest, played by Linda Cardellini and Janet Varney. And I think that an old love interest from the M-Bar days is going to make a... I believe, I've heard this whispered, is going to be making an appearance soon. Like a kind of forever love interest.
Can you let me guess who it is?
I don't know who the actress is.
Oh, you don't know the character or the actress?
I do know the character.
Oh, you know the character?
Yeah.
What are the initials?
G is the only...
Gina? Jerry with a G?
Do it as Sadie.
Jerry. Gertrude. Glinda. Glinda?
No.
Oh.
Geraldine?
No.
Geraldine. But you do know who it is.
Yeah, and
well, we'll see. I'm excited. I would like to see what this is.
Ben and Ben have talked about it for a while. Okay. I think they're going to reintroduce an older storyline.
Interesting. I need to go home. Let's go see if I can figure it out when I get home. Mike Garvey at Mike Garvey on Twitter says, do you ever get back to Buffalo?
I do from time to time. I get home to Detroit more frequently. I consider Detroit another home. Because of the Detroit Creativity Project, we're back there more frequently. But I was just back home in Buffalo. When was it? It was terrible. It must have been January.
Cold.
Oh, it's terrible. The winters of my youth in Buffalo were astounding, like blizzardy and snow days and snow above the first floor windows and stuff, or up to the first floor windows.
Wow.
But yeah, from time to time, not terribly often. My family has a cottage in Canada on a lake, and so more often my wife and I go to see them there in the summer to catch fish and do things.
But you would consider Detroit your home?
No, Buffalo's home. I grew
Buffalo's
up.
Buffalo's home where you grew up, but yeah, your family now is in.
Beth's family still lives in north of Detroit, and we're back there. I lived in Detroit only for 3 years, mm-hmm. but in that time it really did become a home. Like it feels, I was at the Second City Detroit there, the now defunct Second City Detroit, and in that 3 years, Detroit really planted a flag in my soul. Like Detroit's a wonderful place that's scrappy and I believe can become the phoenix from the ashes. Mm-hmm. There's just a vibe there. There's just a life force of creativity and goodness and history and something very cool about Detroit.
Do you think it's going to come back? Do you think it's going to be able? Do you think young people and artists moving into Detroit are going to bring it back?
I think without that it can't happen. But again, I don't know anything about anything.
Without that it can't happen.
Right. I think that the artists movement and that is beginning to happen because uh-huh. you can buy a house in Detroit for $1,000. That stuff is beginning to happen, and you know people are coming from all over the world. They're calling it the New Berlin. Like people are coming, you know, artists are coming from the Netherlands and Denmark and Sweden and things to buy houses for nothing and live in them. And there's a program called, I think it's called Write a House, where if you're a writer, they will give you a house suitable to live in, like something that's been fixed up to a point. And there are a number of these things, a number of programs where people can kind of homestead almost within the giant city limits of Detroit. Geographically, Detroit is very large.
Right.
You can fit Manhattan, San Francisco, Chicago.
What?
Dallas, it's like...
This I did not know.
Yeah, it's huge. Square miles-wise, it's too much to police, too much to fire, too much to plow and garbage and all those things.
Wow.
So without the artists, I don't think it can happen. But I know nothing about business, but I know enough to know that without some new manufacturing angle, without Tesla batteries or biofuels from algae from the Great Lakes waters or whatever, there needs to be some sort of manufacturing base because Quicken Loans and companies like that are rooted in Detroit are doing just about everything they can.
Mm-hmm. They lost their film tax credit.
They did. They had a 42%.
There were programs to retrain the manufacturing mm-hmm. workers to be crews for shows. Now they just lost.
They lost it a couple years ago.
Was it a couple years ago? I thought it was more recent than that.
No, I think it's been a little while that at least it was in question because I know that some fairly big movies, I think including maybe like Iron Man, moved to Ohio because the tax credit was in question.
Ugh.
I don't understand. Again, I don't know much about our business, but the tax credit thing I think is dicey. Like I think it's a loss, it's a losing proposition for the cities and states that offer it. I think much like mounting the Olympics or the World Cup, like that stuff costs that city a lot, and then they're left with not much.
Well, now it sounds like you are up to speed on SAG rules or the news about this particular subject, because I am not.
Neither am I. I just have a deep
and I would like there to be a California tax credit so that I don't have to move
travel.
Out of state in order to work.
They just approved one.
Did they?
Did they?
Since we've been sitting here?
In the last 10 days.
Really?
Okay, well, yeah. But is it anything?
It's $100 million, I think.
Okay. That's one
so
movie now.
That's one half of one Transformers movie.
Well, it's more.
That's a Transformers sound.
It was really good.
It's good, right?
Yeah, it was really good.
I wish I had invented it. I know.
I know. I wish you owned it. That or the gong gong in Law and Order.
The chung chung. Yeah.
That. Oh.
Yeah.
That's a great gig writing that theme song.
Mm-hmm.
Mike Post.
Take that, Mike Post.
You knew it too.
I did. Yeah.
Name some of Mike Post's other greatest hits. Go.
Doom, 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 doom. Oh, a lot of
Yeah.
CSI. I mean,
no, that's The Who.
Oh shoot, you're right. Wow.
My post did.
I feel like Hill Street Blues.
Oh, it's all cop shows.
Rockford Files.
Rockford Files.
Was it?
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Ooh, may I ask another question?
Oh, by all means.
This is from Facebook. Moritz Schwarzer. Schwarzer.
Schwarzer?
Schwarzer.
That can't be right.
Yes, S-C-H-W-A-R-Z-E-R. Moritz Schwarzer.
All right.
Well, which boats did you sail on? Mm. And what is your favorite sailor's yarn?
Sailor's yarn, okay. I sailed, so in summers after high school, summers during college, one of the old Block Island ferries from Connecticut had been sold into the Great Lakes, into Buffalo, to run from Buffalo, New York to Crystal Beach, Ontario, to kind of like a Coney Island, like an old amusement park kind of thing. And it was brought back in the 90s to make that run. Back in the 50s, there had been a boat doing it called the Canadiana, like a ferry boat. And people met their spouses on this boat, like it was a dance hall kind of thing.
Ooh.
And so the guy that owned this great eccentric dude named Ramsey Tick owned the QRS Music Rolls Company, the Player Piano Music Rolls in Buffalo on Niagara Street. And in the late 90s, he brought, I'm sorry, late 80s, 88, he brought back, he bought one of the Block Island ferries, brought it to Buffalo and named it the Americana, and we did that very same thing and would go back and forth. So I was a deckhand aboard the MV Americana, the motor vessel, which was like a small ship, and I did that for 3.5 years during college, and then it got sold to St. Lucia and we delivered it out the St. Lawrence Seaway. And then after college, I was a deckhand on the schooner Malabar in Traverse City, Michigan. And she was originally built as the schooner Rachel and Ebenezer. And then I was the first mate of the schooner Mercantile.
I'm sorry, wait. There was a schooner named Rachel?
Rachel.
Oh, Rachel, sorry, I misheard that.
Race War Ebenezer.
Okay.
And then I was the mate on the schooner Mercantile out in Maine in Camden, which is
Maine, I know.
Mm-hmm, it's part of the Maine Windjammer Cruises fleet. The Grace Bailey, the Mercantile, and the Mistress.
That's a lot of words.
Mm-hmm.
Names of boats and things. That's a lot of boats you worked on.
Oh, no, not a ton. I mean, I would still be doing it if you could make money doing it.
Would you prefer to make money doing that, to acting?
No, this is really fun.
It's a tough one, right?
What's your favorite seaman's knot?
Did you just say that to say seaman?
Yeah.
Is that why you did that?
Yeah.
Do you know how to do all those knots?
Not all.
You have to.
I mean, there
and
are
not
books
from
books.
Memorizing it off of like a placemat at a sailor restaurant. I feel like I tried to learn how to do all those from a placemat.
They're all very practical knots that have their place at sea. That you know, like they.
That you need.
That you need. So I know. I mean, I don't know all of them. I wouldn't say that. But
can you do the fake one, the one that you fake out?
Sure.
What's that called? A slip knot? No, what's it called? A fake out knot? There's a way to make a knot, but it looks like a knot, but it's not a knot, and you just. Or is that a magician
not
trick?
A knot.
Could you just keep doing this for like an hour? That's fantastic.
Okay.
Yes, I know some knots, yeah.
If you could, from Goggles, at Goggles Girl Twitter, if you could play any other character on the Thrilling Adventure Hour, who would it be and why?
It's a good question. I would say Frank Doyle, but I know that I can't do it. Like,
yes, you can. It would be a different Frank Doyle, but you'd be great.
Why are you angry about this?
No, because I feel like it's interesting to me that you've said, because you said earlier too, oh, well, Trulio got it and he's great and it couldn't be anything else but him on Brooklyn Nine-Nine. But you are great. It would be different,
sure.
But it would be great. You as Frank Doyle would be different than Paul, different from Paul,
sure.
But great. And I feel like when you answer this advice question about what do you wish you knew when you started out, and you were saying, you know, your points about auditions,
right.
You're not necessarily auditioning for, and also have an idea of a life of the person. It's not just memorizing sides.
Right.
Have an idea of,
yeah.
I would say, assist a casting director.
Oh, interesting.
Read with actors coming into audition,
yes.
Which I learned so much from that,
yes,
because
you find
out, oh, these guys are all great.
Or you decide.
There's maybe two people that aren't right for it. How do you decide who's the person that you go with? Because everyone's different.
Was Neil Simon's book called Rewrites? Is that?
I have not read that one.
I think that I may be right about that. But I experienced exactly what somebody said in that book, which was that they came to read, they witnessed an audition, and they said, oh, wow. The people in the audience aren't selecting them. The actors are selecting themselves. Like, the actors are coming in going, I've got this role, or I don't have this role. Like, the confidence with which you approach something like that is really essential, I think.
You think so?
Well, I know so. But that comes from not caring. That comes from not from knowing that you're not going to get that role.
I think, you know? Yeah. Well, it's the idea that it's not your job now.
Right.
You don't have the job. You're not losing it.
There's
it's not your
lose.
Job.
Right.
You go in and maybe you can. I do like the idea of just present your version of who this is. And if that's what works, great. If it doesn't, it doesn't.
Sure. In the context of the Thrilling Adventure Hour, I think that what I mean is that I wish I could do what Paul does. You know?
Really?
Yeah. It's amazing. What he does is
Paul is brilliant. I just think that it felt important to me to correct
you. To yell at me briefly?
To school you. That you would be a great Frank Doyle, as Paul is a great Frank Doyle. They're different, but Paul is, I mean, now to me, he's Frank Doyle.
I guess what I
obviously,
mean
obviously, it's
canon. It's canon. I feel like it's established.
He's incredible at it.
All I know is that from time to time, back in the day, we would rehearse sometimes, and when you couldn't be there, when Paul couldn't be there, various of us tried to do your Sadie voice and Paul's Frank voice.
Oh my gosh, that's
funny. Nobody can. Nobody on the planet can.
Huh.
Yeah, they are unique.
Well, that's nice. I'm happy to hear that. Thank you for saying that. I think you would be fabulous as a Frank Doyle.
Well, you're wrong.
Not Paul's, but your own. Kevin Donnelly at Carrie Freakin' Grant. Twitter. How excited are you about Stargate reboot?
Oh, I'm very excited. They announced last week that they're going to reboot the Stargate feature franchise.
Hmm.
What's that about?
Tell me.
No, Sam just went,
Oh,
yeah.
Oh.
That,
What?
I'm excited about it.
It was a franchise? What? I thought there was a movie and then a whole series of shows.
Franchise.
Oh, okay.
Are you in it?
No, but I'm a fan. The Stargate feature was fine, not amazing. But it did a lot of the legwork to establish the backstory that like the pyramids on Earth were had an alien inspiration, that this race of evil, symbiote-filled aliens.
Symbiote-filled?
Yeah.
What does that mean?
It means they've got a snake living in their head.
A symbiote is a snake?
A symbiote, like a you know, like a...
A parasite?
A parasitic,
okay.
Yeah.
Carry on. I like this idea.
It's an interesting thing. It mixes government and archaeology, so it's kind of cool. It's a cool backstory. And the Stargate feature, I feel like, was a little ahead of its time, and maybe some of the special effects didn't live up to. Why are you scoffing at
this,
Sam?
I haven't seen it. I'd like to see it.
I was not scoffing. I was drinking.
You need oxygen.
How does Carrie freaking Grant know that you're excited about this? Is this something you talk about?
This came up at a panel at Comic-Con last year for the Thrilling Adventure Hour. During that Nathan Fillion-led panel, somebody said, "What's the dorkiest thing about you?" And people talked about, you know, their comic book loves or whatever, and I said the words, I can lose a whole day if there's a Stargate SG-1 marathon on, which is entirely true, which is a television series.
There was a spinoff from the movie.
Right.
I have seen none of them.
It's so good.
But I'm glad you like it.
The early ones are fairly good. Yeah.
What else would you say you are a fan of? Like a fan. You'd be excited to work with so-and-so, or you love these books, or like, what are you a fan of?
I hate books.
Oh, that's true. I forgot about that. I'm so surprised by that, honestly.
I know. I just dress this way. I'm a fan of like, like there's a reason that I play the characters that I play, I think. I'm a fan of like Steve Coogan's Alan Partridge is a pretty amazing thing. The British Office, Extras, the American Office. I like Sparks Nevada type characters that are sort of, you know, simple dudes with big egos. Mm-hmm. Like I like those kind of flawed people that fancy themselves more put together than they actually are, than the rest of the world perceives them. But yeah, I'm a fan of that. I'm a fan of golf. I'm a fan of sailing.
Because you have fans that are rabid. You know, they adore you. They love you. They wait for you outside after the shows that we do, and they send in fan art, and they want to take their picture with you, and they dress up like you. And I think it's interesting to me that fans of what you and I do in that radio show are surprised to hear that we're fans of other things.
Isn't like,
of course, every person is a fan of things.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm excited about Stargate, because honestly, I haven't seen it.
Stargate,
and I like that you're a big fan of this thing that I've never heard of, because now I can check it out.
It's cool. And if you, I would recommend the older Star Trek stuff, too, like the original.
The original show, yeah, I like that.
But I mean, even Deep Space Nine and Next Generation and stuff.
I've never gone into those.
There's time. There's time during this interview.
Time. Oh, stop it! How long it...
Almost 2 hours.
We've been doing this for 3 hours?
No.
11 minutes?
Two.
Oh, that's what time it is.
It's 3 o'clock.
I thought we did. You don't know how clocks work.
Hey, you know they gave Jay Davison $1 million?
Who's that?
He was the bad guy in the Stargate movie.
Oh, really?
And you remember, he'd only done one other movie before that, which was The Crying Game.
Right. I know exactly what you're talking about.
And he didn't want to act.
I did see that. He's a pharaoh.
Yeah, he
didn't
want to act.
Yeah, that is a good movie.
And
I saw that movie.
It comes back to what we were saying. The best tool in the actor's tool belt is saying no.
Yeah.
And he said no like 8 times.
And they gave him $1 million.
And they gave him $1 million.
You guys, I'm not doing the Kevin Fox I'm not doing it. Putting my foot down. No.
Do we get paid for this, or? $20 in my bra.
Talk to Zach.
Rika. R-I-K-A.
As it should.
Space, M, period, at Antipodes, or Antipodes. Antipodes, got it.
Antipodes.
What the? Who's got the slippery elbows out there?
What is that?
Was that Koechner? What was that?
That was Koechner.
It was Koechner.
That wasn't supposed to happen yet.
Wait, I shouldn't ask this question.
Was this a T5?
Oh, what is a T5? Oh, this one. Oh, you want to do this?
Oh, you have to.
Oh, I was
clearly no one has told you. If you're going to do a T5, you have to say, we're going to do a T5, and then we intro with Koechner. But that's okay. We've intro.
But I didn't say T5, did I?
Clearly someone out there knows it's a T5.
When we finally put this show on the air, I feel like we should work some of this stuff out first.
Yeah, this has been a great rehearsal.
No, this was just a question from Twitter, but that's okay. We can do a T5. You ready?
Yes, he's ready.
Okay, so
what's happening?
T5. Oh, the wheels are coming off. Kevin must be thrilled. Listen, here's a T5. It's a rapid fire. Mm-hmm. Five questions, this or that, Coke or Pepsi, no correct answers, or no incorrect answers.
That's which one is it?
Yeah.
Either or.
Okay. Correct.
They were all created for you by whoever wrote them. Well,
correct.
Usually they're player specific.
Okay.
So, that in mind, Paget, be my guest.
And these are all for Jim Jeffries.
Yes.
This is from Sarah, at Paget Greta on Twitter.
Oh, are you not aware that some people put
they do?
The word
I have seen that. Yeah,
their,
yeah. I have seen that.
Prentice.
Yeah.
That happens.
Yeah. Well, it's a weird name, Paget. I don't know.
Let's talk about that.
I recognize that when I see it. I recognize it as my name.
What word?
Stop it.
What misspelled word was it meant to be on your birth certificate? Pageant.
No. Tell you later. You ready? Croach or Sparks?
Sparks.
K or Gin?
Gin.
I don't even know what that is.
Special K?
What is that?
Ketamine?
Is that a drug?
Yes.
Is it a martial artist or a
no,
drug?
No, it's a horse tranquilizer.
Wow, well then, no, we're not, that's, I mean, are you?
Gin.
Do you like drugs? What's
no.
What's gin? No, gin with a J. It's some kind of drug.
Oh, I don't know. K or gin?
Yeah. Script or improv?
Improv.
Acker or blacker?
Pass.
Aaron Ginsberg.
California or Michigan?
California.
Hmm.
Yeah. It's pretty great here. 70 and sunny year round, you would love it.
It is fantastic.
It's pretty great, right?
But a lot of people are moving here.
Oh, too.
That's
many.
Why traffic is so bad, because so many people move here.
Mm-hmm.
Because, I mean, why wouldn't you?
Why wouldn't you?
I grew up in Massachusetts.
You know what we need?
Mm-hmm. Snow is, it's, winter is deathly.
Where
it's
in
very,
Maine
very
did
cold.
You grow up?
Cushing, not far from Camden.
Where is Cushing?
It's Mom and Dad were teachers in a boarding school, so we lived in a dorm all year.
Uh-huh.
And in the summer, they have a house in Cushing, Maine, which they've now retired to.
Which
little
is
tiny
where?
Town.
Like Damariscotta?
I've been to the Damariscotta Oyster Festival.
Okay.
So that was within driving distance.
Wiscasset?
Camden. Wiscasset, Camden, Rockland.
Rockport.
Camden's probably, Rockport, yeah.
Oh, both, the Rockland and Rockport
right.
exist, yeah.
Camden's probably closest.
Okay.
Waldoboro.
Sure.
Yeah.
Lincolnville?
It's beautiful.
Oh, that's
Lincolnville,
one.
I don't know.
It's just, it's the next town north up US 1 from Camden. Oh, it's the best in the world.
And you lived in Camden?
I lived in Camden Harbor. I lived
when
on
you were shipbuilding.
Yeah, when I was working on
you could
scooters.
Go build ships in Bath.
T5!
We do you want to do another one?
We have another T5.
Oh, there he goes.
Is it a special one?
It's an anonymously submitted T5.
You have one that I don't...
That Jamie has.
Oh, great,
yeah.
Great. Jamie, go for it.
For you. Okay. Mm.
These are for me?
These are for you.
Aziz Ansari.
All right, that's correct. Okay, number one, bourbon or single malt?
I brought single malt.
Okay. Brooks Brothers or J. Crew?
Brooks Brothers.
Ralph's on Lincoln near Rose?
No.
Or the Ralph's on Admiralty Way?
Admiralty Way, not the ghetto Ralph's.
Okay. Bow tie or sweater vest?
Bow tie.
Your final for this series of Tweet Fives, J.K. Simmons or Kevin Pollak?
Kevin Pollak. Kevin Pollak wrote these, didn't he?
That is correct.
It is.
Yeah. Yeah. Kevin Pollak.
Oh, how is he doing? Is he online with you? Is he saying, oh, no.
He's doing.
What a disaster. I should never have asked her to guest host for me. Poor
he's
Marc Evan Jackson.
Right now.
He was watching earlier, and he texted me earlier.
Uh-uh.
He did. He texted me, and he said, it looks great.
I don't believe you. I don't believe you.
I had, this is what happened. You were doing the low T ad, and I texted him and said, how are we doing? And he said, turn your phone off.
I swear to God. He texted me. Here's a screen grab, and then a little bit of back and forth.
Yeah.
He's so good. And I remember when I was a guest on the show, I couldn't believe how good he was at interviewing.
Yeah.
Just flawless. I mean, really, he just, it all flows, and he knows everything. I just obviously winged it because I don't know how to do this.
I cannot wait to begin.
But you should, you would like to host
this. Let me know when you guys are rolling.
Wouldn't you like to host this?
Sure, of course.
To guest host while Kevin's out of town?
Yes, and you had a monumental task, because imagine if the person sitting in my chair had done anything and was interesting to talk to. Like, if you had John Landis.
No,
I'm saying.
No, that's crazy.
It's not crazy. Like, what if you had, you know, somebody that with, you know, major films under their belt or whatever to talk to, it would go even easier. You wouldn't spend a lot of bullshit time on French horn, I'll tell you that.
No. Well, here's the thing is, I feel like you've answered a lot of questions about acting. I don't want to ask you all the questions that everyone has asked.
Okay.
About, and this, you know, I did want to know, how did you choose between all these things that you were doing? Why did you choose to do this? And when did that epiphany happen? And you
sure.
told me it was an aha moment, and that's interesting to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked for your advice about, should I have a vision board or a dream catcher, or should I, and that's interesting to me, but I you are, even having worked with you once or twice a month and been on the road with you for 9 years, you are still a mystery to me. Because I never see you spin out or behave badly, or you never appear to have human frailty.
Oh, that's absurd.
And that's fascinating to me.
Oh, well, only because you've misread the universe.
No.
Yeah.
No, I think that you must have grown up in a loving, healthy home.
I'm sorry, I did.
No, which I think is wonderful.
No, I did. I absolutely. No, I think I'm fairly well adjusted, but.
But that is unusual for, as Sam was saying before, most stand-ups come from havoc.
Sure.
And that's how they are able to be.
If only someone would make a documentary on the subject.
Mm. You know, I saw Jackson get sweaty once.
In what regard?
In drones, we were shot in Baton Rouge.
Yes, what about
Louisiana?
And it was, we were standing in the front of the building, and then we had to go in the front of the building, and there was no air conditioning there. We had to shoot.
Oh, I thought you meant that you saw me in a panicked situation. You meant the temperature was hot.
Yeah, it's humid there, and your body started to combat it by
perspiring. You guys cracked my story because you had follow up questions, but I was just gonna say I've seen him sweat.
Yeah. No, I'm enormously frail and flawed and, human.
You say that, but I've never seen it leak out of you. I've never seen you behave in a manner that was selfish or insecure or fearful. And I think I wish I could be more like you. I wish I could be more like that. I wish I could project that kind of fluid, charismatic confidence all the time. And I think most people would like to feel the way it looks like you're feeling.
I'm in love with who you think I am.
But you're fabulous and you're good at everything and you're always kind and dressed well and you don't sweat. I've never seen him sweat. You smell. Actually, you know what? I don't think you wear cologne.
I don't.
Yeah, I like that. I don't like a lot of, I don't like
Bay rum from time to time, but almost never.
Hey, get a room, you two.
No, I think he's fabulous.
Shut these cameras off. That's very kind.
Do you want children?
No.
Me neither.
Are you giving some away with that?
No, I just was wondering, and you could have passed on that question.
No. I was just curious
if you and Beth had thought about it, because we're not going to do it. And
no.
it was very hard for me to admit that to anybody until recently.
No, I know how children are made, and I'm great at it. Beth and I, neither of us have felt the biological imperative. There are kids in our life in every direction. All of our friends have kids, and so they're around. And then it's really nice to, be with them and then not be with them and go home. And there are kids all over my family that we, in whose lives we're involved. I think there are plenty of kids in the world.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's how I feel with volunteering at 826 LA. I'm like, I love these kids for 3 hours. And then I get to give them back to their parents.
Right.
So do you want kids or no? Maybe. It's a maybe. You don't know yet.
Pass on this?
Pass.
Oh, you can pass.
Pass on this.
Fabulous.
Do you have AIDS?
I do not. Remarkable. No, I've never done any. I've never done intravenous drugs.
No.
I've had sex. I mostly used condoms, though. So it would it's unlikely. I was kidding when I.
There you go. Round of applause from the booth.
This was again. I was trying to do this before. Rika or Rika?
Oh yeah.
At Antipodes, which I think
Antipodes
is, but it's Antipodes, like a Polish last name. What was your favorite book as a child?
Really?
Really? I'm curious.
He doesn't read.
No, but there had to be something.
This is maybe why. Let's get to the bottom of it. The Lorax.
That's my favorite children's book.
I love that book.
I can recite it.
I feel like that takes me to a place where I think about books like Are You My Mother and The Lion Who Needed a Haircut. Like, those are little kid books. But then I think The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, like some of the CS, like that stuff, Narnia Chronicles. But I don't know. What's happening now?
There's a monitor saying we have to wrap it up. Do you know how to do the Larry King game?
If you've
Do you want to tell him?
Oh, I've heard of this.
You know how to do this.
Do I?
Yes. Okay. I want you to give me a bad Larry King impersonation.
Okay.
But now here's what's going to happen. It's going to be Larry King at the end of his show.
Sure.
You, as a bad Larry King, are going to toss to someone on the phone with a specific city name.
Okay.
You've seen Larry King, so you know how he says, Spokane! So,
I'm sure,
now you can't use Spokane. Well, I think you can come up with something funnier than Spokane, but you're also admitting something terrible about Larry King that he wouldn't want anyone to know.
Okay.
So as Larry King, but poorly, admit something about yourself you don't want anyone to know, and then toss to the caller, correct?
Yes. So something about Larry, something from his past.
Okay.
An experience, a memory, anything. And then toss to the phones, and if the city name is funny sounding, it helps.
Okay.
And that's it. And it must be a bad impression. We do not want a good one.
Fear not. I do not have a good Larry King.
I thought you might.
Something terrible about himself.
About Larry.
Sign off for the show. Something terrible about himself, and then toss to a funny-sounding city.
Yeah, you're not signing off. I'm saying
It's not a sign off. It's just
not a sign off to the end of the show. I did say that incorrectly.
I'll give the Kevin prototype that he's given 200 times on this show.
Okay.
Thanksgiving before the guests arrive. I like to teabag the gravy boats. Schenectady, go.
Very good.
By the end of this week, I will finally have lost my foreskin. Battle Creek, Michigan, you're on the air.
Awesome!
Is that how it works?
That was good. I love Battle Creek,
good.
Michigan.
Yeah, Battle Creek.
Battle Creek.
Battle They're Creek hanging Sanatorium.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Kellogg.
Kellogg, the inventor. Yeah, I did that for Drunk History.
Told
that story.
We
have
need
you done that? You got to do that. You've done that, right?
No.
Oh.
No, I've enjoyed yours. Do I drink?
Oh, yeah, but you never get out of control.
No.
I forgot he had a bottle on his table. but yeah, no, you're very good. You're very good.
That's how you sum up?
You're good at drinking.
Oh, I'm all right. Not perfect. We should hang out more and you would see me be selfish.
On camera.
And no, I don't know if I could do that.
It's pretty gross. It's rough.
I think it's
tough to go that long.
I don't know if I possess the vulnerability to allow myself to get messy on camera. You seemed put together the entire time, and when you put Derek in your grandmother's Halston, it was pretty amazing.
Did I seem together?
Yeah.
It was bad.
Was it bad?
Oh, there are two breathalyzers that you're blowing.
Yeah.
And it was one, like a 0.14. For a lot of it,
that's a lot. That's high. Yeah.
You know who can be drunk and you'll never know?
Who?
Paul F. Tompkins.
Is that right? Really?
I gave him a breathalyzer.
Really?
And he was drunk and I had no idea.
Why do you have a breathalyzer?
Oh, because I got it at Radio Shack after I did Drunk History. I was like, I want one of these in the house.
Wow.
Just to have. You know, you'd rather have it and not need it than need it and not have it.
Like a life preserver.
Or a gun. That's our time. That's how we do it.
Mm-hmm.
Next week, Kevin Pollak's chat show will be the return. Oh, thank
yes.
God, lucky all of you, for Kevin Pollak.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to thank my guest, Marc Evan Jackson.
Thank you.
And the crew.
Yeah, crew.
Do you want to say something?
I'll thank the crew by name. We got J-Mac out there. We have Josh Negrin. We have Danielle Overland, our social media maven. Here we have Kenny Chen, Jamie Foxx, me. Sonia was covering our makeup today, thanks to her.
Sam Levine.
And you are wonderful.
Paget Brewster, ladies and gentlemen. So good.
Thanks.
And our fantastic guest, Marc Evan Jackson.
Thanks, everybody. This was really fun.
Oh, good. I hope so.
So do we take a break and then do the second one, or how do we...
This is
oh
just
God, we don't, do we?
Oh no, this has just been for us. We're gonna do the live one in about 10 minutes. That's it. You got a sign off line?
I did. No, I thought I signed off.
Sign it off.
Signing off.
Say those words
what?
On the monitor.
Get out of my face.